That concludes our questions. The next item of business is debate on motion 5172 in the name of Murdo Fraser on Scotland's economy. I would invite all members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on Murdo Fraser to speak to and move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This afternoon, the Scottish Conservatives will use our debating time to highlight our concerns about the Scottish economy, and in particular the growing divergence between Scotland's economic performance and that of the rest of the United Kingdom, the Sturgeon slowdown. We want to examine the reasons behind this, press the Scottish Government for action, and propose our own solutions for improving Scotland's economic performance. Above all, we will ask the Scottish Government to drop its high tax agenda and its ruinous plans for a second independence referendum. Presiding Officer, last year at this time, we were in the run-up to a referendum on EU membership. Ahead of that vote, there were many warnings from economic forecasters as to the negative impact on the UK economy of a vote to leave the EU. I was part of the Remain campaign, and I shared many of the concerns that were being expressed on the impact a vote to leave the EU would have. As it happens, as we know, the UK economy has defied these predictions. It has been growing strongly since last summer, much more strongly than was previously forecast. Yes, of course.
John Arthur.
I just wonder if Murdo Fraser would recognise that these forecasts were based upon the UK leaving the EU. It hasn't actually left the EU yet.
The member is totally wrong. The forecasts were for the economy at the point where we currently stand, after a vote to leave. The forecast said, including the IMF, incidentally, who said the UK economy would lag. Now, I don't know if the member was paying attention. Just yesterday, the IMF revised upwards its growth projection by the UK economy by 0.5%. That is the biggest upward change the IMF has ever made in its history. So the British economy is growing. The member needs to pay more attention. And the unemployment rate has continued to fall. The employment rate across the UK is now 74.6%, the highest rate of people in work since records began in 1971. In a second. That is a story of economic success, Presiding Officer. I'll give way to the Cabinet Secretary.
Keith Brown.
Unemployment, growth rates projected for the UK economy. Is he able to explain why it's the fact that the unemployment rates between Scotland and the UK diverge, with unemployment being lower in Scotland? And can he explain the statement that he made previously when he said the SNP government cannot evade responsibility for this failure as the gap between UK and Scottish unemployment rate continues to grow? It does. They've got higher unemployment than we have.
That's right. Murdo Fraser.
Me, Cabinet Secretary. You would really think the Cabinet Secretary for the Economy would actually understand the issues. The reason the unemployment rate in the United Kingdom has been falling, according to the Fraser of Allander Institute, though I suggest know more about this than the Cabinet Secretary does, is because people are coming out of the jobs market altogether. There's been a rise in economic activity. Now, if the Cabinet Secretary for the Economy doesn't understand that, if he doesn't understand his own figures, he shouldn't be in his job, Presiding Officer. So, there is much to celebrate in the growth of the UK economy. High growth rates, record levels of employment, falling unemployment and solid levels of business confidence. But there's just one fly in the ointment. This good news stops at the border. For the situation in Scotland is markedly different from that elsewhere in the United Kingdom. And it is only in Scotland, unique across the United Kingdom, that we're seeing this economic underperformance. Because in Scotland over the past year, our economy has been flatlining, not growing at all over the 12 months to quarter four 2016, as opposed to growth of nearly 2% across the UK. And in the fourth quarter of 2016, the most recent one for which we have figures, the output of the Scottish economy actually contracted by 0.2%, while across the UK as a whole, growth was 0.7%. Another quarter of contraction, and we are officially in recession. The Sturgeon slowdown will have become the Sturgeon slump. Now, these headline figures mask a more serious problem in that the active economy, defined as a measure which strips out public sector activity and focuses on private sector non-financial services, contracted by 0.6% over the last year, compared with growth of 3.6% across the UK. And on this measure, Scotland's active economy over the last 4 years grew at just 2%, against 13% growth across the UK. We have grown at 1/6 of the UK average. And the figures elsewhere are a little better. Scottish workers have had the lowest rise in gross annual pay in the UK in any region and Scottish business confidence is significantly lower than the UK as a whole, according to the Federation of Small Business. Now, let's look at the unemployment figures that the Cabinet Secretary was talking about, because what is clear, yes, unemployment in Scotland did fall in the most recent figures, but what Fraser of Allander say is that this is driven by the rise in economic activity. It's not about jobs being created, it's about people taking themselves out of the economy altogether. And the employment rate in Scotland is lower than the UK average, and Scotland lags behind every single other region of the UK on job creation rates. I don't know why the Minister is shaking his head. These are the facts. He has to start taking responsibility for the actions of his government. So the picture we have, presiding officer, is absolutely clear. While the economy of the UK as a whole grows strongly, in Scotland we have a specific Scotland-only problem. Our economy is not growing, we are not creating more jobs, and wages are not rising. So how do we explain this divergence between the UK and the Scottish economies? Well, we had our answer from the Finance Secretary 2 weeks ago. I notice he's not in the chamber this afternoon. Perhaps he's still on holiday. Perhaps he's being hidden away this afternoon. And that's not surprising. For his response was a laughable one, almost as laughable as the concept that Sir Jamie McGregor has just joined the SNP, presiding officer. And his response was ridiculed in all quarters, for he tried to blame Scotland's relative underperformance on Brexit. As Professor Graham Roy of the Fraser of Allander Institute put it, much more diplomatically than many others did, and I quote, "With any Brexit uncertainty affecting the UK as well, it is hard to argue that Scotland's relatively weaker performance can be explained by the outcome of the EU referendum." So, presiding officer, as I've said, that is putting it diplomatically. Others put it in much more colourful terms. For it is simply ludicrous to blame Scotland's relative economic performance on a factor that affects the whole of the United Kingdom. Why is it that every part of the UK is doing well, just not Scotland? No, it must be a specific Scotland-only issue. Now, we're very happy to have a serious conversation with the Scottish Government about what the factors applying to Scotland alone might be. But in the absence of any more credible explanation than blaming Brexit, which is the go-to excuse from the Scottish Government when anything goes wrong, let me propose two possible causes. The first is the question of tax. Now, we know that the Scottish Government has extensive tax powers, and the recent budget passed by the SNP with the support of the Greens means that 1 in 7 income taxpayers in Scotland will pay more tax than if they stayed elsewhere in the United Kingdom, up to £400 a year more. On top of that, we have council tax rises, seeing families, not at the moment, seeing families paying more than £500 a year extra in some cases, and we already have the increased tax on business, with a large business supplement being double the rate that applies south of the border. And let's remember that this large business supplement, this misnamed large business supplement, applies to many comparatively modest retail premises which happen to suffer from high rateable values because of their location. And on top of that, we have the lands and buildings transaction tax, set at the upper end of the market at higher rates than elsewhere in the United Kingdom. And it's no wonder that the draft budget 2017-18 had to revise downwards by some £750 million, the take from residential LBTT from between 2017-18 and 2020-21. Indeed, the Scottish Property Federation pointed out at the end of last month that the targets for LBT take for the current year were £100 million short of target, with just 1 month to go in the tax year. Presiding officer, it's no surprise, because if you set the tax rates too high, you depress economic activity and you end up with less tax revenue as a result. Yes, I've got time. I'll give
Gillian Martin.
Would you agree that for ordinary families, what's actually going to affect their income and the economy is the fact that the decrease in benefits given to, tax credits given to families with children of three or more, it's actually going to take about £7,000 out of their annual income, and that's actually a more serious impact on families, ordinary families in Scotland.
Murdo Fraser.
That is an astonishing intervention from somebody in the SNP benches who wants to take us down the route of independence that will leave a £15 billion black hole in the public finances of Scotland. If you think welfare cuts are an issue, why on earth do you support a policy that's going to see austerity max imposed upon the people of Scotland, which is what you want? Let me go back to the issue of business rates. It's no wonder they're causing so much concern. The recent rates revaluation saw businesses throughout Scotland reacting with horror to huge increases in their valuations. Now, after pressure from ourselves and others, the Finance Secretary agreed to cap the increases for the hospitality sector at 12.5% for the coming year. He didn't tell us, perhaps he didn't realise, that in fact this wasn't a cap at 12.5%, it was a cap at 14.7%, because he'd forgotten about the impact of inflation. And just this afternoon, I've heard from Fife Council that because the Scottish Government laid its regulations to implement the cap so late, the rates demands that they're issuing now to businesses do not take this cap into account. They will be asked to pay the higher figure. And I would ask the Cabinet Secretary, is this a specific problem for Fife, or is it occurring right across Scotland? Because if so, he needs to get it sorted. And we've also heard elsewhere that this cap may not be automatically applied. It will be up to businesses to apply for it themselves. And in the meantime, they'll be expected to pay the higher sums. It is simply a shambles and sums up this government's lack of understanding of the business community. And this is a government that's done nothing for all those other businesses not protected by its cap. So whether it's children's nurseries, renewable energy projects, garden centres, there are a whole host of other businesses which contribute to our economy and provide jobs. They're all seeing a dramatic increase in their rates bills. Over the recess, I met with two hoteliers in Perthshire who told me that unless real action was taken on their rates bill in the longer term, it would no longer be viable for them to do business beyond next year. That is the impact this government's policies are having on the Scottish economy, and it's time they thought again. And there's a second factor doing damage to the Scottish economy, and it's the ongoing uncertainty caused by this government's obsession with a second independence referendum. And a whole host of business figures, from the Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors to the Institute of Directors in Scotland, have warned of the impact that this uncertainty will have on their ability to do business and the ability to attract investment. A corporate study survey by the law firm Burness Paul found that 88% of firms thought that the prospect of second independence referendum was creating uncertainty for Scotland. 50% stated that their company would not feel comfortable undertaking investment activity until the outcome of another referendum was known. And 83% said it was vital for Scotland to remain part of the United Kingdom. The evidence is absolutely clear from business. The uncertainty caused by the prospect of a second independence referendum is damaging Scottish economic recovery. Presiding officer, I have set out what we believe are the problems with the SNP's approach. So what are the Scottish Government going to do about it? Well, let me give some suggestions, some practical suggestions of what they might do to improve things. Firstly, the Scottish Government has very extensive powers on taxation. It should be using these to create a competitive tax environment in terms of business rates and in terms of personal taxation, including LBTT. Secondly, we need constitutional stability. We need to rule out a second independence referendum, which the people of Scotland simply do not want. Thirdly, there needs to be a renewed focus on improving productivity. The Scottish Government should be working with the UK Government, helping develop an industrial strategy, one focused on innovation and promoting research and development. Fourthly, there needs to be a renewed focus on exporting, with the role of Scottish Development International enhanced, particularly in non-EU countries. Fifthly, we need to do more to see our cities as drivers for economic growth. The UK Government's initiative for city deals is now being rolled out to every city in Scotland. That's a welcome initiative, but it needs to be supplemented by Scottish Government action. And finally, we should empower local government to assist growth. And I would commend to the Chamber the ideas we have to do this contained in our local government manifesto launched this very morning. Presiding officer, above all, the Scottish Government needs to think again on its damaging policies for Scotland. It needs to think again on tax, and it needs to think again on a second independence referendum. If it doesn't do those things, presiding officer, we will continue to see jobs disappear, our economy will continue to suffer, and the Sturgeon slowdown will become a Sturgeon slump. I have pleasure in moving the motion in my name.
Thank you. With no time in hand, time is very tight now. Call Paul Wheelhouse, Minister, to speak to and move Amendment 5172.3. 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Before setting out some of the actions of the Scottish Government to strengthen and grow Scotland's economy, I'd like to reflect that it is clear from Corporal Fraser's speech there that the Tories are setting out to ignore the fundamentals of Scotland's economy, which are strong. And for the record, Scotland's GDP per head is 99.9% of the UK average. Scotland has achieved strong productivity growth since 2007. Productivity per worker has grown 9.4% in Scotland, in comparison with 0.1% for the UK as a whole. Scotland has a strong and resilient labour market, and I'll repeat this for Mr Fraser. The latest figures show unemployment in Scotland at 4.5% is lower than the 4.7% in the UK as a whole. And since 2008, employment in Scotland has risen by 45,000. Scotland has a very supportive, just in a moment, I'll just finish some points. Scotland has a very supportive ecosystem for new businesses. Since 2007, the number of registered businesses in Scotland has grown by 15% to an all-time record level, and indeed, a survey for Export Market cited Edinburgh as the best city in which to start a business as part of a study of 43 UK cities. And the value of Scottish international exports has increased by 41% since 2007, from 20.4 billion to 28.7 billion by 2015. And Scotland's business expenditure in R&D, not as high as I'd like, but rose by over 40% in real terms between 2007 and 2015 to reach 871 million. I'll give way to Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving me. I don't know if he's familiar with the Fraser of Allander Institute, but I do think he needs to read their analysis of what is happening in the Scottish economy. The fall in unemployment is down to a rise in economic activity. It's not because jobs are being created, it's people leaving the labour market. And the increase in productivity, according to Fraser of Allander, is down to less hours being worked, not an increase in output per hour. Why doesn't the Minister actually study the figures rather than making bland assertions?
Minister.
Professional economist for 19 years before I was elected to the Parliament. Yes, I do know Fraser of Allander Institute very well, and I've worked with the Fraser of Allander Institute. Indeed, I would just point out to Mr. Fraser that since 2008, at the peak of economic activity, prior to the recession, UK-wide recession, Scotland's employment has risen by 45,000. So just get that in perspective. The Scottish economy has remained resilient in 2016 despite the significant challenges that continue to face the oil and gas sector and the heightened uncertainty that has been created by the UK's decision to leave the EU. Since the Brexit vote, consumer confidence in Scotland has indeed fallen and is lower than in the UK as a whole. But we can see, even if the Tories cannot, that Captain Theresa May and First Officer Johnson seem intent on steering a collision course for the SS Brexitania rather than to steer it away from the economic icebergs. We can see the problems are coming. The Tories seem to be ignoring it. However, only this week, Begbie's trainer, Insolvency Petitioners, and he might want to listen to this point, Mr. Fraser, gave us welcome news that the number of Scottish businesses facing serious financial hardship is falling, bucking the upward trend for the UK as a whole. They found that firms in Scotland saw a 28% reduction in the most serious signs of business distress during the first quarter of 2017, compared with a 7% increase across the UK. Ken Patullo, who leads Begbie's trainer in Scotland, said, and I quote here, overall the supply chain in the UK is facing challenges from a weak pound and rising inflation, in particular in fuel and food costs, unquote. And in case the Tories have missed it, I highlight it went on to state, and I quote again, there is no doubt that these Brexit effects will keep impacting parts of the Scottish economy too. However, despite headwinds, Scotland's economy still grew 0.4% in 2016, and Scotland's labour market has continued to show very welcome resilience. Latest data to February 2017 shows that our unemployment, as I said earlier, not only outperforms the UK average, but also outperforms on both female and youth employment rates. The 0.2% contraction in the Scottish economy in the final quarter of 2016 stems largely from the continued slowdown in the oil and gas sector and the impacts this is having on the wider supply chain. In that context, I welcome Begbie Traynor's assessment that, and I quote here again, it would appear that we have seen the peak of distress in that sector. Clearly, we need to remain vigilant, given the oil and gas sector is still fragile. I acknowledge that. But if the peak has indeed passed, then that would be great news for the oil and gas workforce and the sector, which has a long-term future in Scotland. The Scottish Government remains committed to supporting the oil and gas sector through measures such as the Energy Jobs Task Force, our £12 million Transition Training Fund, and new £5 million Decommissioning Challenge Fund. TTF in particular has assisted more than 1,800 individuals affected by redundancy to date, and up to a further 755 are being provided with new employment opportunities through two larger scale procurement rounds. Furthermore, the Partnership for Action on Continuing Employment has, in the year to 31st of March, supported 15,167 employees and 299 employers across the economy, with 2016 PACE Client Experience Survey published last October suggesting that some 71% of those assisted had found new employment. And that is an excellent service, I would argue, Presiding Officer, that is only provided in Scotland, to the best of my knowledge. Mr. Fraser, I'm limited for time, if I may have to press on briefly.
Mr. Lockhart.
Just The contraction last year was a blip. Why is it that under 10 years of the SNP, average annual growth in Scotland has been a mere 0.7%, a third of our long-term growth rate? Can you explain why that's the case?
Minister.
Well, I think as we'll come on to discuss, that the UK government also has a role in the management of the economy, which is something that has point has been made already to Mr. Fraser. He may not like it, but those powers are still reserved. So I think we both have to accept, both the Scottish government and the UK government have to accept that we'd like to see improvement in economic performance in Scotland. But I've already highlighted a number of examples where Scotland is performing extremely well in comparison with the UK. And Mr. Fraser mentioned renewables. Last week's Baringa studies demonstrated that at least 1 gigawatt of new onshore wind can be commissioned without subsidy, but UK government, because of the 2015 manifesto, continued to deny a route to market for that technology, alongside 812 megawatts of islands wind, 1,072 megawatts of pumped hydro capacity, and 150 megawatts of tidal projects, all held up because of a lack of support from UK government, potentially billions of capital investment for Scotland and the wider UK supply chain. And the Scottish Government is also investing in the wider economy to boost growth and create jobs over the longer term, including investing in our future through our £6 billion infrastructure plan and the £500 million Scottish Growth Scheme. Hundreds of millions of pounds are being invested in transport, housing and energy efficiency, and £400 million of investment in digital connectivity to mitigate failings in another area that is reserved to Westminster. We are committed to reducing the burden of air passenger duty to improve Scotland's connectivity, and we plan to invest more than £1 billion in our universities in 2017-18, and are supporting collaborations between universities, businesses and others through our innovation centres. But it is vital we retain access to Horizon 2020 and other key sources of funding. We've established a board of trade and are creating permanent trade representations in Berlin to add to our innovation investment hubs in Dublin and Brussels. The new innovation investment hub in London was opened officially by the First Minister yesterday and will provide Scottish companies with a place to meet clients and customers, target new markets and secure investment. And we are increasing the number of modern apprenticeship opportunities to 30,000 per year by 2020. These investments in our economy are crucial, both in the short term to support Scotland's economy during these uncertain times as the UK embarks on a hard Brexit, but also as investment in the long-term productivity of our economy. We are using our tax powers to support growth in the economy. On business rates, our actions demonstrate a continuing commitment to competitive business rates environment, and we've reduced the overall rates burden by around £155 million and ensured more than 50% of all properties pay no rates this year, with over 70% paying the same or less than last year, 8,000 business properties no longer paying the large business supplement, and the overall core business rate poundage being cut by 3.7% to 46.6 pence. We provided specific rates relief schemes for office accommodation in North East Scotland for renewable projects and the hospitality sector Scotland-wide, all measures the Tories voted against in the recent budget vote. The economic outlook for Scotland remains positive, Presiding Officer. However, the main risk facing Scotland's economy continues to be the prospect of a hard Brexit. And Brexit presents a huge threat to jobs, to trade, to living standards and investment in Scotland. Brexit will take Scotland out of the largest single market in the world and threatens over £12 billion of exports from our country. So, Presiding Officer, I move the amendment, in the name of the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much. And I did add a little extra time on for interventions, but it's now very tight. I call Jackie Bailey to speak to move amendment 5172.1. Ms. Bailey, 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I welcome any opportunity to debate the economy, although I have to confess I think the debate is wholly overshadowed by events elsewhere. But before I turn to the Scottish economy, let me make an observation about what businesses tell us that they value. And this was confirmed just this morning on Good Morning Scotland by David Watt of the Institute of Directors. Businesses value certainty. And I think it is fair to say that this is the last thing that the UK and Scottish governments have actually given them. An independence referendum in 2014, with all the uncertainty that that meant for the economy, a general election in 2015, a Scottish Parliament election in 2016, an EU referendum a month later, now another general election, and the threat of IndyRef 2. Whilst Barbara from Bristol may have summed up the nation's view, I think it is safe to say that the stable, certain environment for business is truly non-existent. The only thing that is constant is change and Murdo Fraser's interventions.
Mr. Fraser.
I'm very grateful to my favourite Labour MSP for giving...
I think that's your intervention finished.
That's all my intervention.
I'm afraid you must sit down, Mr. Fraser.
I mean, What a waste of an intervention, presiding officer. But you know, it actually reminds me that the last time the Tories took us to the polls, it was to sort out an internal party problem over Europe. And look where that got the country. Out of Europe, the entirely fictitious promise of more money for the NHS and David Cameron out of office. Now, the new Prime Minister looks intent on using a general election to silence her internal critics. I can but live in hope that she will suffer a similar fate to her predecessor. But it was, of course... No, hold on. It was, of course, Theresa May herself that long held that a general election during the Brexit negotiations would be damaging to businesses and households. Well, what a complete U-turn on her own position, because it's clear now that she simply doesn't care about the damage that would result. Whilst I, like most politicians, quite enjoy elections, the reality is that the Scottish economy, which is already in a precarious state, might suffer further. The uncertainty of an election clearly does not help. And I will relish the debate, but I can't help but think, as someone once said, now is not the time. I believe our collective focus... It is uncomfortable hearing this, I accept that, but you should listen. But I do believe our collective focus, whichever parliament you are in, or whichever party you belong to, should be on growing the economy. Because whatever set of figures the SNP tried to spin, we don't start from a strong base. The economy is not just stagnating, it is in decline. The last quarter's GDP figures show a contraction in the economy, negative growth of -0.2%, and this at the same time as the UK economy grew by four times as much. That trend, that difference between Scotland and the UK is also played out over the full year. The key areas that contracted include construction and production, and I would urge the Scottish Government to look particularly at these areas when considering investment. Bring forward some of the capital infrastructure and housing projects that will make a difference in these sectors. Because there is no doubt the Scottish economy is underperforming against the rest of the UK across a number of measures. Growth is down and has been revised downward. Employment levels are decreasing. There are 17,000 fewer people in employment for this quarter than a year ago. There is greater underemployment in the workforce, and worklessness is increasing, so that economic inactivity levels now stand at 60,000 more than they were in the last year. And the Scottish Government hasn't taken the time to understand what lies behind this increase, which is ultimately bad for our economy. I know the Minister is shaking his head, but I have to say I found his speech entirely complacent about the needs of the Scottish economy. Just yesterday, the Scottish Retail... No, I think we've heard enough. Just yesterday, the Scottish Retail Consortium reported that retail sales were down... You might listen to this. Retail sales were down for the last month. And although food sales appear to have gone up, this is largely as a result of price inflation. That should concern us all. Retail matters to the Scottish economy. Encouraging productivity and growth in this sector is important, and it is really time that the Scottish Government invested in a dedicated retail strategy. The truth is that Scotland lost out on billions because of the SNP's mismanagement of our economy. Failure to return to pre-recession levels of growth has cost the economy in Scotland £6.5 billion since 2011. With our new powers over taxation, we absolutely need to create jobs, to increase revenues, to ensure we have enough
just
to invest in public services.
I don't like people whistling. Somebody was whistling now. So you're not in a class, so I don't need to ask you to stand up, but you know, we'll not have that.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I have to say, you'd think that after a decade of the SNP being in charge, we would have a government focused on boosting growth by investing in the economy and creating jobs. Instead, what we see are breathtaking cuts of some 40% to bodies like Scottish Enterprise, the very agency charged with growing the economy. Quite simply, the SNP government are not serious when it comes to dealing with the economy. Either that, or they really don't know what they're doing, and I'm not entirely sure which is worse. Just look at the economic strategy. Now, there is much in it that we support, But the ambition and warm words are simply not matched by action. There is little monitoring, little forward direction, and to suggest that it should not be fundamentally reviewed in light of Brexit is astonishingly stupid. And then we have the SNP's plans for a second independence referendum. No longer once in a generation, but once every few years. This would be economic vandalism on a truly breathtaking scale. Just the prospect of IndyRef2 will cause damage to the economy, never mind independence itself. And the SNP can't even tell us that most basic of questions. What currency will we be using? How do we fill the £15 billion black hole in our accounts each year? You know, there is no greater ambition, presiding officer, than to grow the economy. But that ambition must be matched by action. Investment in growth, investment in skills, investment in our businesses, and certainty to help them invest in the future. We stand ready to work with the government, but it really must pull its head out of the sand and focus on the economy, not on another independence referendum.
Please move your amendment.
I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. Call Patrick Harvey. Mr Harvey, to speak to and move amendment 5172.4.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome this debate on the economy, and I'm glad that it hasn't wholly descended into a debate on independence and Brexit alone. It so often happens, although I have to say that when the opening Conservative speaker called for a period of constitutional stability, I almost choked on my watermelon. I really did. The Green Amendment, which Deputy Presiding Officer, I move now in case I forget to do it later, focuses on two main themes. The failure to invest in a transition away from the fossil fuel age and toward long-lasting, high-quality and sustainable economic activity for the future, but also the inequality which persists in our economy, because narrow metrics like growth alone are not enough. Even productivity alone are not enough to tell us about the quality of economic activity as opposed to its quantity. There is indeed a strong economy for some. The top 10% of the Scottish population have more than doubled the income gap between themselves and the bottom 40% in just 1 year. In just 1 year, that gap has more than doubled. And that's in keeping with the rest of the UK. The richest 10% of UK households hold 45% of all wealth. The poorest half of the population, by contrast, own just 8.7%. Yes, the number of the proportion of working age adults in employment is at a high, but the number of people in working poverty, the number of people in working poverty, in a family in working poverty, is 55%, also a record high. And the Scottish Government's statistics show that 20% of people in Scotland were living in relative poverty in 2015-16. For those who enjoy a position of wealth and privilege, you can indeed identify a recovery, a strong economy. That claim can be made and they will enjoy the fruits of that. But far more people are experiencing a labour market and an economy characterised by low wages, bogus self-employment, and precarious employment through the so-called gig economy. That's the shiny new name, of course, that we have for just old-fashioned casualisation, but this time with apps. I don't think we should be excited about this. We should be concerned about the people who are being exploited through it. And the Tory government is pursuing policies which will actively make poverty and inequality worse. Much has been said about the impact from the cuts to tax credits and universal credits. The idea that in response to Gillian Martin, that Murdo Fraser seems unable to recognise that taking thousands of pounds from a low-earning or average-earning household is somehow to be ignored, while taking a few hundred pounds from people like us on high incomes is so much more devastating in the economy, I simply find this laughable. All of this highlights that inequality is the context in which we need to read what the numbers such as narrow economic measures like productivity and GDP tell us about the economy. Another factor that's ignored by those narrow economic metrics is, of course, sustainability. Now, Brexit has, of course, endanger our economy, that much is certain, and the internal party squabbles of the Conservatives look set to trigger an opportunistic snap election and a power grab to undermine both parliaments. But when Murdo Fraser asks the question, why the divergence between Scotland and the rest of the UK, he cites tax policy, even though his beloved Fraser of Allander Institute have pretty much blown out of the water the claim that Scotland is the highest taxed part of the UK. And he also suggests it's because of the debate on independence. But the divergent performance he points to starts after the 2014 referendum. And before, in fact, in the run-up to his party's reckless decision to pursue hard Brexit. And so I don't think that referendum can be the issue. He mentions the Fraser of Allander report on several occasions. That analysis concludes by saying the independence referendum does not appear to have been a major driver of volatility. We find that global events such as the Eurozone debt crisis tended to have a much more significant impact. And later on, in that same analysis, it cites the downturn in the oil and gas sector as part of the explanation. I find it astonishing that Murdo Fraser wants to look at tax policy or the constitutional debate as though the uncertainty is all coming from Scotland, not the UK, and ignoring the fundamental structure of the Scottish economy. And I welcome him if he's now got some nice new fruit and vegetable-based insults for us. That would be great fun.
He certainly will not, Mr. Fraser.
Thank you. I'm grateful to the member for giving me. Does he accept the Fraser of Allander Institute analysis he's just quoted refers to the impact on financial markets, in other words, on stock prices, not on the impact of the broader economy of the constitutional debate?
It seems to me that from a reading of the Fraser of Allander's publications and from what we know about the economy, it is bizarre to dismiss and ignore and not even refer to the over-reliance on the fossil fuel industry, which is central to Scotland's position. Burning just the fossil fuels that we have in known reserves, we know, will tip the climate system into disarray. So that resource will never be successfully turned into profit or economic activity. We cannot allow the dependence of our people's livelihoods to depend on that volatile global price and that unburnable resource. This much is certain. And I would also quote Douglas Fraser from the BBC, who said, "Down in the doldrums with Scotland was Russia. Those over-dependent on oil revenues, as well as those afflicted by war, dominate the list of those with contracting economies." I simply don't think we can dismiss the reality of this issue, and it really should focus our minds on the urgent need to invest in a sustainable alternative. I don't have time to go through the opposition, the other amendments, Deputy Presiding Officer. We will be voting against all of them for different reasons, and my colleague Andy Whiteman will explain that in summing up. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much. I call on Mike Rumbles to speak to and move amendment 5172.2. Mr. Rumbles, you also have 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Scottish economy is not in a good place. And it isn't as though the Scottish Government hasn't been warned about the fragility of our economy, the problems of business confidence, and the problems companies face over skills shortages. The Liberal Democrats have argued that what is needed from the Scottish Government is transformational change in our education and skills base to build a high-wage, high-skilled economy. Now, we argued this most recently with the government ministers during this year's budget process, but unfortunately, the finance minister had already decided his budget beforehand. The evidence for this is the almost magical appearance of extra money, which, while appeasing the Greens, did not come anywhere close to providing the funds necessary for the transformational change that we believe is needed. We all know, don't we, that business doesn't like uncertainty. The Conservative motion argues that the Scottish Government should set aside its campaign for another independence referendum and focus on the economy instead. Now, the Liberal Democrats couldn't agree more with this view. The Scottish Government's actions on this divisive call for another referendum do indeed undermine business confidence in Scotland. However, looking at the Conservative motion, it is indeed the kettle calling the pot black. There are two main reasons for the lack of business confidence in Scotland. Yes, It is the worry, the real concern, over the future direction of our country caused by the constant campaigning rather than the governing of the SNP administration. But it is compounded by the actions of the previous and current Conservative prime ministers over Brexit. The threat of a second independence referendum, coupled with Brexit, is sending a chill through the Scottish economy. The Fraser of Allander Institute recently reported, and I quote, the unprecedented political and economic uncertainty generated by Brexit and IndyRef2 is likely to act as a further headwind for many businesses and potential investors. And since it is the Fraser of Allander Institute, Mr. Fraser's choice quotations, I'll give way to him.
Thank you.
Mr. Fraser.
Grateful to the member for giving way. If indeed it is the case that Brexit is causing a fall in business confidence, why are we not seeing that reflected across the whole United Kingdom, but only in Scotland? Because there is a gap of 30 points in business confidence between Scotland and the rest of the UK. Surely
Before you reply, can I ask members not to have two members standing at the same time? Mr. Rumbles, will you reply now, please?
Yes, I do accept that there is a difference between the two, but just imagine how the growth could be in the south of England, in England south of the border, if we didn't have that threat. No, absolutely. Surveys such as the Federation of Small Businesses, again, often quoted by the Conservatives, Index 2 indicate that business confidence is low. Scottish firms expecting the economic outlook to improve are outstripped by those who expect the situation to deteriorate. Now, 2 weeks ago, we saw the Scottish Chambers of Commerce warn that companies are facing a lack of digital skills. Of the Scottish businesses that took part in its national business survey, 8 out of 10 reported some form of shortage of digital skills. Companies and organisations in almost every sector of the economy are struggling to find the skills they need. The Liberal Democrats are the only party in this Parliament who will work to change the direction of the whole of the United Kingdom and work towards securing Scotland's economic future by avoiding a hard Brexit and keeping Scotland in both the United Kingdom and European Union single markets.
Patrick Harvey.
I'm sure that if Mr. Rumbles is committed to changing the direction of the UK, he'll do what his party leadership has not done at UK level and rule out any form of cooperation with the Conservatives after this snap election.
Mr. Rumbles.
What a red herring that is, Mr. Harvey. I mean, quite frankly, we're not interested in coalitions, quite frankly, and I'm sure the Greens aren't either, because I don't believe the Greens will win one member of the Scottish Parliament in Scotland. Never mind, let's get back to reality. I want to look at the economic facts facing Scotland. During the Easter recess, we learned that in the final quarter of 2016, as has been already mentioned, Scottish GDP shrank by 0.2%, while the UK economy as a whole grew by 0.7%. There is no indication, and I didn't hear it on the front bench today either, that any minister has given much thought to the possibility of a recession and how to avoid it. No minister has publicly acknowledged the risk of a Scottish recession, not even in this debate. Now, with a lag in publishing statistics, we could already be in a recession. We just won't know that until July. What action have Scottish ministers taken to ward off the threat of recession? Instead of playing the blame game, and I've heard that already in this debate, the Scottish Government should be setting out clear and credible plans to turn the situation around. The Liberal Democrats, in our case, will not give up on our call for a transformational investment in education and skills training, because that's where we think the key to this is, and to get Scotland's economy fit for the future. I want to turn to the Conservatives again here. I have to say, it takes some gall for them to bring forward this motion today, the day after they go to the country to try and consolidate their hard Brexit. And I know it's difficult. It's difficult for me to listen to most of the Conservatives in this chamber, because most of the Conservatives in the chamber don't actually believe in a hard Brexit. They didn't argue that now, but because the leader says jump, they jump. So a hard Brexit, but it's a hard Brexit that will do immense damage to the economy of the whole of the United Kingdom. And I can't think of a worse self-inflicted wound. There's no getting around it. Barriers, and I thought the Conservatives would appreciate this, barriers are bad for business. People and companies are already paying the price of Theresa May's approach. Ruth Davidson knows the cost of that too. When we have the reckless hard Brexit of the Conservatives, the last thing we need is the divisive approach of the Nationalists. But the electorate now has the chance to change the direction of our country, a chance to turn back the tide of division, a chance to give our country a brighter and better future. The Liberal Democrats are open, tolerant and united, while the Tories and the Nationalists offer propositions that would harm our economy. We stand with a majority opinion in this country. We stand proud for a united kingdom within the European Union. And I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rumbles. We now move to the open debate. Event speeches were tight, 6 minutes. I call Joan McAlpine to be followed by Liam Kerr. Ms. McAlpine, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The Tories have an absolute brass neck in bringing this topic to Parliament today. Before the European referendum, the UK Tory government said Brexit would, quote, make us permanently poorer. Yet yesterday, the Prime Minister announced a general election, the sole purpose of which is to ensure the delivery of the hardest Brexit possible, one that will make us permanently poorer, and which the Fraser of Allander Institute research, not quoted by the Tory motion today, has said will result in the value of the wage in people's pockets in Scotland falling by £2,000 in real terms, and which will cost Scotland at least 80,000 jobs. That is the real insecurity that Scotland faces, Presiding Officer. And that warning does not just come from the Fraser of Allander. In a piece of work published this week, the World Economic Forum gives a devastating analysis of the impact of Brexit on the UK economy as a whole. According to their calculations, based on the direct costs, such as job losses from the financial sector, as well as inflation eroding income and savings because of a drop in the value of the pound, Brexit will cost Britain £140 billion, or 7.5% of GDP. That, they say, is the equivalent of £300 million a week over 8 years. £300 million a week, Presiding Officer, a familiar figure in the context of the Brexit debate. But the World Economic Forum has more to say about the British economy under the stewardship of the Tories. They are unimpressed by the bragging about recovery at a UK level. They explain it this way, and I quote, after an eight-year recovery built on rising asset prices and debt, but stagnant wages, the poor and the old will see their incomes and savings dwindle. The canary in the coal mine is the pound sterling, which has already dropped from over 1.50 to 1.25 against the US dollar. For an island that imports half its goods and food, this means higher inflation. High street retailers are already feeling the pinch, expect even smaller portions, less fruit and vegetables on the shelves. Brexit uncertainty, they say, could also scare off some investment and push jobs away. In fact, some firms are already relocating elsewhere. The Minister has already outlined at length the substantial work being done by the Scottish Government to support the Scottish economy, with unemployment now lower than the UK as a whole and the second lowest youth unemployment in the whole of the European Union, which is something that we really should repeat more often. They are achievements, Presiding Officer, that come despite the policy of the Tory government in London, which has far more influence on Scotland's economic fortunes than anything that happens here, I'm afraid. The fact is that 70% of Scotland's taxes are still set and controlled by Westminster. Monetary policy lies down in London, as does fiscal policy. So does energy policy, something alluded to by the Minister, a critical factor in the Scottish economy. That's controlled entirely by Westminster. And what an absolute pig's ear they have made of it, Presiding Officer. We know that some recent challenges faced by the Scottish economy result from a fall in the oil price, something that was not predicted by anyone, including the UK government. And during the independence referendum, the UK government, David Cameron, in fact, said that the North Sea was best left on the broad shoulders of the UK. But the UK government has squandered that national resource. Over the last 5 decades, North Sea production has generated over £330 billion in tax revenue, and all that went straight to the UK Treasury when it could have been invested in Scotland's infrastructure and put aside for the future. In Norway, a small independent country, oil revenues have been invested wisely and there's now a sovereign wealth fund of $900 billion. What an indictment, presiding officer, on the failure of successive UK governments to safeguard Scotland's most precious resource. But the mismanagement of energy is not confined to oil, presiding officer. The UK government under the Tories has, since 2015, sought to sabotage our renewables industry and what can only be described as a series of spiteful measures that undermine the Scottish economy. Scotland's ability to attract investment in the renewable sector is being hampered by UK government policy. The UK position in the EY Renewable Energy Country Attractiveness Index fell to the 14th place in October 2016 due to, quotes, uncertainty caused by Brexit, the closure of DECC and the approval of the Hinkley Point C, all dealing a sizeable blow to the UK renewable sector. In February 2016, the Energy and Climate Change Committee reported that investor confidence had been dented since the UK parliamentary election in May 2015, and they identified six different factors that have combined to damage investor confidence, including sudden and numerous policy announcements that have marred the UK's reputation for stable and predictable policy development. The UK government has been criticised by a wide range of experts and stakeholders in this area. For example, Andrew Watkin, head of energy and marine team at the property consultancy Carter Jonas, stated that the plans will, quote, kill off the solar and offshore wind industry in the UK from 2016 forwards. The figures are stark, presiding officer. They show that investment in wind, solar, biomass and waste-to-energy projects could decline by 95% between 2017 and 2020. And these are areas... No, I need
the
to
members
make
in our last 30 these, seconds.
These are areas, presiding officer, that are particularly important to the Scottish economy. This is just one aspect of many aspects of the Scottish economy where the control lies entirely with the UK government. They have made a mess of it. They've made a mess of it in the past. And because of Brexit, they look to make an even bigger mess of it in the future. Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you. I call Liam Kerr to be followed by George Adam. Mr Kerr, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. There are things that keep me awake at night. Ensuring Scotland has signed the climate change agreement with one of the 50 states of the USA. Ensuring Scotland spends millions on an over-budget baby box scheme, which, according to research by Kantar, people neither want, respect or even use. Spending days debating whether or not this Parliament should ask a question, to which the answer is already known. Spending 31 hours debating Brexit, but only 7 on education. These are things that concern me. On that point, a question only, please.
Mr. Dornan.
When we're talking about things that keep you awake at night, what about the rape clause? How do you get on with that?
Let's try and keep this relevant, shall we? There's actually, we've been written to, Peter Chapman has given a very good reply to that to your colleague Gillian Martin. I suggest you go and ask her when there's more time. What does keep me awake at night is the Scottish National Party's stewardship of the Scottish economy, because whilst the UK economy grows at 0.7%, the fastest growing economy in the Western world, whilst UK job creation rate is 8.6%, the Scottish economy has a job creation rate of 1.7% and a lower employment rate than the UK average. It has a lower GVA growth per head than in England's northeast, northwest, Yorkshire, the Humber, the southeast, the southwest, and Wales. Scotland's active economy contracted by 0.6% over the last year, compared with growth of 3.6% for the UK. And according to the Scottish Government's own figures, the Scottish economy grew 0% over the last year, compared to 1.9% for the UK. And then we've heard about the Federation of Small Business statistics, which show that the confidence of Scottish small businesses remains significantly below the UK average. But my insomnia is a function of two things. Firstly, that the government in this debate will, I confidently predict, totally and willfully fail to acknowledge any of the problems, or indeed their agency, in them. They will blame the Tories, Brexit, Westminster, perhaps a lack of powers, or if you're Joan McAlpine, all of the above. Secondly, there is manifestly, staggeringly, and absolutely no plan to rescue the situation. This government has the power to do something. They have the power to do something about it now. We might not agree on where the blame lies, the responsibility, nor would we necessarily agree on the solutions.
But surely the very least a government should be doing is presenting those solutions, presenting a roadmap to success. A roadmap that says, here we are, and using the following levers, here's the plan for how we are going to get out of it. And in 5 years' time, here's where we'll be. But instead, no thank you, we have a finance secretary who set his proposed air departure tax rate at a particular level because it felt like the right thing to do, who announced with much fanfare a capping of business rates for hospitality businesses at 12.5%, but forgot to account for inflation, so it'll be 14.7%. Jair's figures, trumpeted 3 years ago as the basis for the economic case for separation, and now, when they start showing that Scotland's a net beneficiary from the rest of the UK, derided as nonsense. And a government who preside over people's council tax going up, business rates going up, income tax going up, LBTT going up. And all, of course, requiring the complicity and support of the Greens, who have been revealed to be the SNP in all but name, but with added virtue signalling and less economic credibility. Specifically, a party whose leader admitted in March 2016 that he did not know how much extra revenue his party's preferred top rate of tax would raise, but would continue backing it, even if it didn't generate a penny more. Now, there are solutions, which Murdo Fraser suggested and others will no doubt articulate. But we need, above all, stability and certainty. Whatever our desired outcome, we can surely all agree that certainty does not come from a bipolar second referendum, where the outcome is, by definition, one of two polar opposites. Or a prospective country in which the currency is not certain, the status of membership of the EU is not known, and the existence of a hard trading border at Berwick, losing a single market worth four times as much to Scotland as the EU, is a distinct probability. And therefore, whatever our individual aspirations, it is incontrovertible that the threat of a second referendum is causing economic damage. Just this week, the serial entrepreneur Robert Kilgour reported how he regularly comes across financial investors that no longer consider Scotland as a place to put their funds. Deputy Presiding Officer, I have no doubt this Parliament is unconcerned with my nocturnal well-being. But it must be concerned that this government is spending vast amounts of time and money tinkering around the edges whilst the economy of Scotland labours. The lack of any form of concrete long-term plan to deal with the economic underperformance is concerning and must be addressed. I've set out the basis and the paradigm within that, which that plan might operate. But look, the people of Scotland demand stability in our institutions, predictability in our policies, and consistency in our decision-making. So I say to the Cabinet Secretary, please, in your summing up, tell me the Scottish Government has got a better idea. Set out a comprehensive and coherent plan to turn the economy around without blaming everybody else. Set aside the campaign for a second referendum, support the Conservative motion, and let me get some sleep. Thank you.
Yes. On the matter of sleep, I think your speech woke up a baby, Mr. Kerr. I called George Adam to follow by Polly McNeill. Mr. Adam, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland has one of the strongest economies in the world, with advantages and resources few nations can match. But if you listen to the Conservative Party, you would think otherwise. You know, there are questions that keep up Liam Kerr up at night, and I don't doubt that for a minute, because perhaps it's actually the guilt of the pain that him and his kind are inflicting on the people of Scotland. That is probably the reality of the situation. But, Presiding Officer, I've always been a glass full kind of guy. It's my nature. I've always looked to the positives of life regardless of the challenge. And as my old dad used to say, who said it was going to be easy, son? Because important things in life seldom are easy. That's what the challenge is. But it appears that this is lost in the Conservatives as they wallow in their own negativity. You won't hear a Tory MSP talk about building a better tomorrow. They're happy to wallow in their own mucky, sordid vision of the future. But, Presiding Officer, not for me that type of negativity. In constituencies like mine, the small business bonus scheme has made differences in regenerating the east end of Paisley. Obviously, the Tories are not interested in regenerating towns like Paisley because it's under them that the problems have happened in the first place. But 100% occupancy in retail units, many of these actually qualify for the small business bonus, and this has saved businesses in Scotland over 1.2 million in rates alone. This year, the Scottish Government expanded this by removing the rates burden entirely for 100,000 business properties. Politics is about priorities, and the priorities of this Scottish Government has always been the people they serve. While the Tories in Westminster cut taxes for those in the higher rate, the Scottish Government are foregoing the tax cut of £400 that equates to £760 a week and making it contribute to Scotland's social contract, which includes free education, further childcare, free school meals, no bedroom tax and free prescriptions. The abolition of tuition fees saves over 120,000 undergraduate students up to £27,000 compared with the cost of studying in England. The Scottish Government's increases in free childcare to 600 hours saves families £2,500 per child per year, and a total when the expansion comes up to 1,140 hours is the equivalent of 30 hours a week, will save families £4,500 per child per year. Free school meals. All children primary 1 to 3 are entitled to free school meals, saving families around £380 per year and making sure stigma does not stop children who need getting a decent meal. No bedroom tax. The Scottish Government has ensured that no one in Scotland has to pay the Tories' hated bedroom tax, ensuring that 70,000 households, 80% of which have disabled family members, save more than £600 per year on average and able to stay in their own home. And free prescriptions, presiding officer. Scottish patients who need a prescription save £8.40 per item as compared to England. The Tories want to charge patients every time they need a prescription. That would mean a Tory tax of an extra £100 for people with long-term conditions. But of course, presiding officer, we all know that the Westminster Tory government are more interested in making those with long-term conditions suffer under their so-called welfare reforms. Presiding officer, you may or may not be aware that next week is Multiple Sclerosis Awareness Week. And although this year's theme is on MS specialist nursing, the focus over the past few years has been the impact of welfare reform for those living with MS. Now, I mention this for two reasons, presiding officer. The first being that Stacey Adam would probably inflict bodily harm if I didn't mention it, but also the impact that this can have on our economy. MS Society Scotland published a document called MS Enough, and it talks about this impact. The findings of this report are quite staggering, as it finds that people with MS have had to reduce spending on basic essentials and socialising as a result of disability benefit changes. 30% of those with MS spent less on food because of the Conservative Westminster cuts. 25% reduced their spending on gas and electricity, and 47% spent less on socialising with family and friends. All this on the back of Tory welfare cuts. That's obviously had an impact on our economy, and if you increase that to include all those living with other long-term conditions, you can see the impact that Tory economic devastation is causing. MS Enough also found that 80% of people living with MS were forced to give up work within 15 years of diagnosis. So you understand how all this impacts on people with long-term conditions being an active member of the economy, and there are 11,000 people with MS in Scotland. But one of the biggest impacts on our economy, and one that has been created by sheer Tory recklessness itself, is that of Brexit. A hard Brexit will impact negatively on business growth and lead to skill shortages, which will in turn reduce employment, investment and public spending across the country. Of course, David Davis told the Commons Brexit Committee on 15th of March he had done no economic assessment. When asked, he said, "I can't quantify it yet. I may be able to do so in about a year's time." In about a year's time. That shows how much focus and direction the Westminster Government has on our economy. Presiding officer, I stated earlier I believe in facing our challenges head on and finding solutions to problems. The Scottish Government has the same attitude, working within a system that they have had to mitigate against the decisions made elsewhere to protect our nation from the Tories. And they will continue to do that over the next couple of months as we continue to debate the true cost of potentially never-ending Tory rule in Westminster.
Thank you very much. I call Polly McNeill to be followed by Ashton and Ms McNeill, please.
Presiding officer, whatever the positives are of the employment figures in Scotland, overall it is clear that all is not as well as it should be in the Scottish economy. It is surprising that this has not attracted more debate as we wait with concern for the next quarter figures to find out whether Scotland might be in recession. If that was the case, it is already too late to prevent it. But therefore, we must see the evidence that the Scottish Government is using all the available powers to change the trajectory of the Scottish economy, and whether the UK Government, who is also responsible for the Scottish economy, whether it is ready to give an appropriate Brexit solution for Scotland's needs, which are different, as they will be in Wales and Northern Ireland. The solutions that are being presented are a choice between hard Brexit, out of the single market, or independence from the UK. Sadly, the general election now called will probably be dominated by these two options. I, for one, will be campaigning to expose the Tory record of failing ordinary people in their everyday lives as the cost of living rises. Restricting child benefit to two children will only add to child poverty they claim they would solve, but crucially, it will not encourage the population growth we need. As others have mentioned, low wages, insecurity in work, the gap between rich and poor, which is increasing, must be at centre stage in this election if ordinary people's views are to be represented. But if Theresa May's real reason for calling a general election is, as she says it is to unite behind a Brexit plan so that she can negotiate for those purposes, then she does need to ensure and provide an assurance that that includes a plan that meets the needs of Scotland too. I have argued in this Parliament many times that that must include a say in immigration to provide Scotland with the appropriate population growth to ensure that we can have the appropriate skills to bolster our GDP, which is markedly lower than the rest of the UK. There has been a diversion in the growth path and in job creation between Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom, which increased around the time the oil price fell. There needs to be a serious analysis around this as to why. It's obvious if we don't know why, then we'll not have the right solutions to tackle it. But the global financial crisis of 2008 should never be forgotten as being the underlying reason for most of our country's problems, current and future. But the two false choices presented by the SNP and the Tories compound the problems that the global financial crash created. But whatever the result of the general election, both the UK and Scottish governments need to be focused on the economy, on the creation of quality jobs with protection at work, attracting inward investment and new infrastructure to give business and consumers some confidence in the long-term plans for our country. Brexit and the manner of Brexit has already caused huge problems for the UK as a whole. Even though the UK economy has showed some resilience, as Tom Arthur said earlier, we haven't actually left the European Union yet, so we haven't felt the full effects. But none of these constitutional choices, if they come to pass, will deal with the fact here and now that action is needed urgently to change the direction that we are currently headed in. Wage stagnation is amongst one of the most serious issues across the United Kingdom. In July last year, wage growth was worse than anywhere in Europe, apart from Greece. UK wages dropped by more than 10% since the financial crash. Francis Grady, the General Secretary of the TUC, said that that represents the steepest decline in real wages since at least the 1830s. Yes, the 1830s, not the 1930s. The story of Brexit was that immigration was presented as the cause for wage stagnation. And it's worth noting that Anton Muscatelli, a respected economist, said in his recent lecture, in many respects, since 2007-2008, real wages have been depressed in the UK. It's got nothing to do with immigration. It has been depressed because of the way national income has been shared between employment and profits, and that's a direct quote. In my eyes, this is another way of saying that unrestrained capitalism has caused this sharp gulf. If we do nothing about the long-term position of wages and not just implementing the living wage, then we will never catch up. Many economists believe that we do not know all the factors which have led to this grim performance of the Scottish economy. However, one key problem is the slow rate of population growth, which appears to be slower than in the rest of the United Kingdom. So I hope it is agreed by all the parties that we must be giving the tools to tackle the slow rate of the growth of the population growth. In concluding, Presiding Officer, I welcome the chance to debate the way forward. I do have one question if the Cabinet Secretary, Keith Brown, is going to be summing up, and that is how the Scottish Government is going to use the £200 million UK-wide apprenticeship levy. That's because I've had some representation that business groups are saying that they are not clear how that's going to be used, and I'd be grateful for a response on that. I conclude, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and in time. Ash Denham, to follow by Rachel Hamilton. Ms Denham, please.
Presiding Officer, in a report last week from the most comprehensive to date research on start-up environments, the firm Expert Market named Edinburgh as the best city in the whole of the UK to start a new business. Edinburgh was named as the best place for new businesses because of things like high-speed internet, strong pool of university students, and reasonable office rents. While this is welcome news, it's not altogether surprising. Edinburgh, like the whole of the UK, sorry, the whole of Scotland, benefits from a government that is investing £400 million to ensure super-fast broadband internet to 100% of properties by 2021. Additionally, £1 billion of yearly investment in Scotland's higher education institutions certainly helps Edinburgh's universities produce a top-tier workforce for businesses. The economy should rightfully be a prime concern for all of us in Parliament, as the policies that we create and support make the difference between our cities, like Edinburgh, being at the top of the economic rankings or at the bottom. Yet I believe that everyone in this chamber also understands that economic policy, in its great importance, is ultimately about what kind of society it provides. It's whether a decent quality of life is afforded to those with less money in their pockets as it is to those with more. It's whether training and education is readily available and accessible so that all people, regardless of income, have a pathway to a successful career. It's whether a climate exists for the creation of good-paying jobs with tax policy that is fair rather than a patronage system to the wealthiest. It's whether the economy is creating equal opportunity for all or just for some. And I believe that under the SNP government, it is equal opportunity for all. As a result, in the past 5 years, more young people from the most deprived areas in Scotland are going to university. Median full-time pay has grown 21% in the last 10 years and is now the highest pay anywhere in the UK outside of London and the South East. Unemployment has fallen, as we've heard, to 4.5%, lower than the rest of the UK, with youth unemployment the second lowest in all of the EU. And productivity, a key measure of sustainable economic growth and long-term health of an economy, has grown four times faster than in the UK. More people getting an education and better pay, more people in work, a more productive workforce. These are all things worth celebrating. But if you lived outside of Scotland and listened only to the Scottish Tories, you would think that this country is a land where no business could prosper and no person could lead a good quality of life. Members of this Parliament, more than anyone, should be champions of this country. Yet, as usual, I will.
Liam Kerr.
I hear what the member says, but does the member accept that there are some problems in the Scottish economy? And if so, can she point to any plan to address them?
Ash Denham.
Clearly, there's always more to do in any economy, and that applies equally to the UK. But I think this is rank hypocrisy today in coming to this chamber to discuss the economy. The Tories come to this chamber week in and week out, claiming that they want to improve Scotland's economy. And yet, when the Scottish Government put forward an entirely feasible plan to keep Scotland in the single market, the Tories will not back it. And I think that tells the Scottish public everything that they need to know about the Scottish Tories and the Scottish economy. and the member should make a decision. Does he speak for London or will he speak up for Scotland? As usual, the Scottish Tories would rather paint a bleak and defeated picture to the rest of the world instead of celebrating Scotland being among the best places in the world to live and to do business. GDP is an important measure of how the economy is doing, which is why this government is instituting policies to try to grow GDP faster. So £500 million for investment guarantees and loans to help companies grow and export, embedding innovation and investment hubs across Europe to boost international exports, which are already up 41% under the SNP, saving properties £1.2 billion in rates through the small business bonus scheme. And it's clear that this government is fostering a country where business development and investment are prioritised. I'm sorry. What is less clear is why the Tories are keen to drag Scotland down a path that would be so destructive. How ironic is it that the Tories lead today's debate on Scotland's economy while all the while supporting Theresa May's hard Brexit at every step of the way, which could cost this country up to 80,000 jobs. How ironic is it that their leader, Ruth Davidson, would not only defend the inhumane Tory rate clause, but claim that Holyrood should spend money intended for vital public services to mitigate a Westminster-created policy? What sort of economic stewardship is that? Not the kind that has the best interests of Scotland at heart, that's for certain. In a time when Scottish industries such as life sciences, financial services and tourism are flourishing on the global stage, the Tories would point to a lack of confidence. Well, my message to the Tories is this: the greatest confidence that this country lacks is from the Scottish Conservatives. I remain confident in Scottish growth, Scottish opportunity and resilience, and I believe that the majority of people who live, work and do business in Scotland feel the same.
Thank you. I call Rachel Hamilton, followed by Ivan McKee. Ms Hamilton, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I draw members to my register of interests and remind them that I am a business owner. Today's debate sets out the SNP's dismal record of performance with regards to Scotland's economy. Brace yourself for a ride on the ghost train along our high streets and past the empty shops. Yes, it's that time of year when the Mayfair visits our local towns and cities and we whoop and holler on the roller coaster rides. But this is real life. The Scottish economy is flatlining. And in this chamber, we will be accused of talking Scotland down.
Yep. Yep.
I say to the Scottish Government, look in the funny house mirror, because it's 10 years of SNP government that's led us, almost every single major business organisation, research unit, institute, even your own Scottish Government figures point out the doom and gloom statistics that exist on Scotland's high streets and in rural towns and villages. Retail is Scotland's largest private sector employer, employing 250,000 people, 13% of the private sector workforce. However, most recent data indicates that there were over 9,000 fewer jobs in the industry between 2014 and 15. We hear from businesses that they're struggling. They're juggling cash flow by robbing Peter to pay Paul. They're deferring payments and stacking up credit charges. Business owners are weighing up the cost of labour versus customer service. Investment plans have been parked and essential maintenance put on the back burner. The Scottish National Party like to blame the vagaries of Brexit. We heard earlier from Murdo Fraser, who quoted Graham Roy from Fraser of Allander, who said it's hard to argue that Scotland's weaker performance can be explained by the outcome of the EU referendum, particularly when the rest of the UK is outperforming and have experienced the same Brexit. Let's take a look at what's happened on our high streets in the south of Scotland. Empty retail units and shops in Galla Shields and Dumfries. Why? Because rents are too expensive and business rates too high. David Lonsdale from the Scottish Retail Consortium says, with shop vacancies increasing and one in every 10 retail premises now empty, there is a pressing need to reduce the cost of doing business. We've yet to hear a convincing explanation as to why firms operating from medium to larger size premises in Scotland are better placed to be stumping up more in business rates than firms in comparable premises elsewhere in the UK. Will the Scottish Government listen to the Scottish Consortium and follow their recommendations? Have they actually read that report?
Nope.
Before I get an intervention about small business rate relief, forget it, because show me the evidence that small business rate relief is working. If it was, we'd see a growth in retail and thriving high streets in the south of Scotland. The divergence in tax rates has impacted on the Scottish economy, and because of this, Scotland is not an attractive location to set up business. A consequence of devolution means that Scottish Government can make different policy decisions north of the border. Those differing approaches have had an impact. Firstly, the impact of a Scottish-specific taxation, such as doubling of the large business supplement, makes operation in Scotland more expensive and affects retail investment. 1 in 10 commercial premises in Scotland pay the large business supplement, and Liz Cameron of the Scottish Chamber of Commerce said that the decision to double the large business supplement puts many Scottish businesses at a competitive disadvantage compared to their counterparts in the rest of the UK, when the Scottish economy is underperforming that of the UK as a whole. She goes on to say, this additional tax affects a wide range of businesses, including shops, offices, factories and hotels, for whom an increase in their fixed costs is the last thing they need at the moment. This moves me from retail to hospitality, two sectors that feed off each other and attract visitors to Scotland. 6 weeks ago, Derek Mackay announced a 12.5% cap on rises for 8,500 pubs, restaurants, cafes, hotels and other hospitality firms. Over Easter recess, I learned that due to inflation, the cap will increase to 14.75%. I also learned that the SNP government has changed the legislation to state firms must now wait at least 105 days before a decision is made on their rates bill. Previously, the limit was just 70 days, meaning those affected will have an additional 35 days of being out of pocket. I think it's great that the front three are actually talking amongst themselves when this is quite a serious business matter. Considering finances for many of these organisations, yes, I will.
I thank Rachel Hamilton for taking an intervention. I was listening to what she was saying. I was actually looking for research to point out, but presumably she will welcome the fact, given she's referring to hospitality industry, that the First Minister on her trip to the United States has managed to sign a deal between TripAdvisor and Visit Scotland to be a massive boost to the tourism sector in Scotland. Maybe she'll welcome that.
I thank Paul Wheelhouse for that intervention. Unfortunately, I don't welcome that because of the very reason that's an unregulated organisation. And if you looked at the International Hoteliers profile on Facebook, you'd actually realise that they don't welcome it either. This is just another indication of an anti-business SNP government that would rather hit firms in the pocket than help boost growth, jobs and the economy. On top of this, the Scottish Government took over 3 weeks to send out guidance to local councils who collect rates on their behalf, resulting in businesses having to pay the original amount before the cap was announced, some bills amounting to between 50 and 300% increase, more than they previously paid, and then try to claim the money back. Just doesn't make business sense. Many businesses will see a dent in their cash flow, and there has been an outcry from the industry who feel they've been misled by the Finance Secretary. To conclude, Presiding Officer, the Scottish retail sector is going backwards under this SNP government. Employment in this sector is down, investment is stalling, cash flow is tight, fixed costs are up, and at top of all, we have a Finance Secretary boasting about business rate policy that is unravelling by the day. I support the motion in Murdoch Fraser's name.
Time is really, really tight, so under 6 minutes would be appreciated. Ivan McKee, followed by Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I first draw the Parliament's attention to my role as the Parliamentary Liaison Officer to the Cabinet Secretary for the Economy? Here we are, Presiding Officer, trying to get on with a day job, creating employment with some 16,000 new jobs delivered over the past 3 months. Scotland enjoying the lowest unemployment levels of anywhere in the UK, achieving the best inward investment levels anywhere outside London. The only part of the UK to be fixing the productivity puzzle rather than just talking about it, with growth and productivity in Scotland 4 times higher than that of the rest of the UK. Dealing with the impact of global energy markets to support oil and gas sectors through the current cycle, with little help from a Westminster government focused on the economy of London and the South East. Making Scotland the lowest tax part of the UK, with savings in council tax, which benefit the vast majority of people in Scotland, more than offsetting any income tax benefit for the top 10% the Tories obsess about. Here we are, doing what we were elected to do, but facing constant interruptions and distractions from a UK government obsessed with exiting the European Union above all else. A Tory Prime Minister diverting UK government resource down the blind alley of negotiating the first trade deal in history. The first trade deal in history where the objective is to make both parties to the negotiation worse off than they were before they started. And then taking the bizarre decision to drag us into a general election. The voters of Scotland know this is a gimmick and they will respond accordingly on the 8th of June. There is in this Tory motion an assertion that the willingness of this Scottish Government to let the people of Scotland have their say in the future of this country is somehow creating economic uncertainty. This from the party that gave us Brexit, diverting the whole of the UK Government away from the day job to satisfy their decades-long obsession with Europe. The irony meter is off the scale. So let's talk about uncertainty. With the FTSE 100 yesterday suffering the biggest single day drop since the Brexit vote, losing 170 points and wiping £45 billion from the value of UK companies when the Prime Minister announced she had no clue how to proceed with the Brexit negotiations, so was going to ask the country a different question instead. That, presiding officer, is what uncertainty looks like, because the hard reality is that hard Brexit... Yeah, take an intervention.
Dean Lockhart.
Also say, at the same time as the stock market had a wobble, the pound increased significantly yesterday. No, it's the other way around. The stock market reacts to the pound, you should know that. Can the member confirm what currency an independent Scotland would use?
Yeah. Ivan McKee.
Where did that one come from? As you know fine well, before we go to the referendum on independence, the Scottish Government will present full details of what an independent Scotland will look like, which is far, far, far more than was presented to the people when before the Brexit vote. We won't just be painting our slogan on the side of a bus. Because the hard reality is that hard Brexit is going to be a disaster. The Prime Minister knows that, and she knows she needs to buy time in the hope that the mess will be sorted by 2022. And that's why we've been dragged back to vote only 2 years after the last Westminster election, and in spite of the much vaunted Fixed Term Parliament Act, it turns out not to be worth the paper it's written on. But thankfully, somebody has done the work to examine, using a robust methodology and real data, what exactly it is that does cause economic uncertainty. And the recent report from the Fraser of Allander Institute takes a long, hard look at volatility over recent years and identifies the political events that drive that uncertainty. And, presiding officer, it makes for interesting reading, because the conclusions that Fraser of Allander comes to are clear. The biggest drivers of economic uncertainty in recent times were the Brexit vote and, wait for it, the UK general election, both of which generated significantly more uncertainty than the 2014 Scottish referendum. This, of course, reinforces what we already know. In the run-up to September 2014, Scotland benefited from strong and increasing inward investment performance, moving up the UK league table to second place after London. We saw a GDP growth per capita in Scotland outstrip that of the rest of the UK. Hardly a sign of lack of confidence in Scotland's future or an indication of economic uncertainty. So if the Tories really are concerned about the impact of political decisions on the Scottish economy, they might want to have a wee word with our Prime Minister and let her know that we've got a day job to do here and can't be doing with this constant indecision and political gimmickry from Westminster. They might want to let her know that now is not the time to shut down Westminster for a month because she can't think of anything better to do. Now let's talk about growing the economy. Scotland, as we know, doesn't have full control over the levers to grow the economy. Key levers are all controlled at Westminster. Corporation tax, tax allowances for business, capital gains tax, employers' national insurance, employees' national insurance, tax on dividends and savings, indeed control over what is the very definition of income. We are trying to run this economy with one hand tied behind our back. Presiding officer, poll after poll shows that the people of Scotland trust this Parliament, this Scottish Parliament, far more than Westminster to deliver for them and to look after their interests. The lack of confidence in the other place will only be deepened by the bizarre carry-on of the last 24 hours. The truth is that to deliver what is needed to achieve the level of prosperity enjoyed by our Scandinavian and other European neighbours, and let us not forget that the top 10 richest countries in the world are all the same size as Scotland, and almost none of them enjoy the advantages Scotland enjoys in terms of natural resources and human resources. To deliver those levels of prosperity, Scotland needs full control over the levers of the economy. That is why, in addition to getting on with the day job, unlike the Westminster Government, we will continue to argue for more powers to come to Scotland so that this Parliament, the Scottish Parliament, can continue to deliver for the people and the economy of Scotland.
5 minutes each for the last three speeches, please. Jamie Green, followed by Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So here we are once again in this chamber discussing an issue that the Scottish Government has neglected to. But perhaps on the issue of the economy, it is either too afraid to or too ashamed to. I'll begin by pointing towards page 12 of their own manifesto that it stood on last year, on a page entitled A Wealthier Scotland. And it states, our focus is on growing Scotland's economy and creating rewarding opportunities for all the people of our country. Well, if that's your focus, you have a funny way of showing it. Yeah. It is depressing to be having this debate today that after 10 years of SNP government, while the UK economy grows, our economy has shrunk. We're no longer talking about lower growth in Scotland. We're talking about negative growth. We're talking about stagnation. We are sideslipping into a recession in Scotland under the less than watchful eye of this government. And keeping in with Mr. Wheelhouse's nautical theme today in speeches, the warnings came like a political Frederick Fleet. Financial iceberg straight ahead. So why did the SNP sail Scotland straight into it, bow first?
Correct.
Of course they'll blame Westminster. They always do. But the truth is that the problem lies much closer to home. Yep. It sits over there. Mm-hmm. What does this all mean on the ground for real businesses in Scotland? And for months now, for example, I've been raising awareness of the private car hire industry, small wedding and special event companies, including one in Solcoats in my region, are struggling with the additional financial burden of regulation. One owner told me that hundreds of small firms could close down. Real companies, real jobs, real people. You only need to look at the FSB's recent survey on business confidence to know the scale of the problem here. This is a government which thinks that wealth creation and entrepreneurialism are dirty words. Scotland lags behind the UK and every other region on job creation rates. The UK rate is 8.6, and in Scotland, just 1.7. These are ONS figures. Is it any wonder the Scottish economy is retracting? How many firms can have confidence in a government which from April 2016 doubled the supplement on the rate for large businesses from 1.3 to 2.6%? What kind of message does that give to businesses? How can our agricultural industry flourish when farmers don't even know if they're going to be paid on time? Exactly. How can households have faith in a government which says if you live in a modest bandy house, you should be taxed more? Yep. How can workers have confidence in a government which says that in Scotland you would be taxed more than the rest of the UK? Yep. So much for focusing on creating a wealthy Scotland. You might pay lip service in your manifesto, but today's debate is a damning indictment of what taking your eye off the ball really looks like in the cold light of day. Yeah. But the SNP's refusal to even acknowledge that there is a problem is what has led us to where we are today. Their motion does not even mention last quarter's contraction. They're burying their heads in the sand. How many more warnings do they need? The FSB, the Fraser of Allander Institute, the Scottish Chambers of Commerce, the Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors, the Institute of Directors, warning after warning on income tax, on independence, on LBTT, on productivity. Are they all wrong? But in the spirit of positivity, I'd like to be helpful here. Here are three simple things you can do. One, take the threat of independence off the table. The First Minister can do this today, not because I'm asking her to, but because Scotland needs her to. Yep. Stop taxing Scottish workers more than the rest of the UK so you can attract the best talent to Scotland from elsewhere in the UK. Before this debate today, I was at an event discussing the skills gaps in so many sectors in Scotland. How can we attract the best talent when we have a sign at the border saying, welcome to high tax Scotland? And thirdly, create an environment that rewards hard work, yeah, not one which penalises ambition. Yeah. Presiding Officer, these aren't just numbers in a spreadsheet. These figures represent the livelihoods of people up and down this country, mm-hmm, who are paying the price of this SNP government. And I tell you what, the sooner this ship sets sail, Scotland can say bon voyage to their mismanagement of its economy.
Gillian Martin, followed by Tom Arthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I tell you, we're not going to be welcoming many people to Scotland when it gets painted like a ghost town in an economic basket case by the Tories, are we? You can always be sure that when a report comes out, the first thing our Tory MSPs and their backroom staff do is scour it to see how badly Scotland comes out of it. And then the second thing they do is check the performance figure for the UK is better than that of Scotland before they make a fuss about it. It's a bizarre way to act for elected representatives of a country. It's also a very strange way to look at our particular economics. These benches look at issues around our economy and see our potential. We see where we can improve and how we can get to where we want to be, and Paul Wheelhouse outlined many of these in his opening speech. That said, when two parliaments share responsibility for the whole package of economic and fiscal levers, for those powers are still disproportionately divvied up between us, we need to look at how the policies of both governments help or hinder Scotland's potential. And I'd suggest that two divergent political philosophies sharing responsibility just is not working. And it's looking like they're going to be divergent for a long time to come. The miserable Tory motion put before us today tells us, don't look over there at the UK government. Don't look at the economic vandalism of Brexit. Don't look at the fiscal maze of partial powers the UK government have given Scotland, which asked Scotland to play poker with half the deck missing. The Resolution Foundation recently released a report concerning the economic history of employment, income and inequality in the UK. And the report projected an increase in income inequality. It states that projected real earnings growth will mainly benefit middle and higher income households, while the proposed cut in maximum benefits cap to £23,000 per year contained in the Full Employment and Welfare Benefits Bill would primarily hit lower income households. Inequality is the single biggest problem for any economy. IMF studies continually point to this fact. An unequal society significantly affects the economic growth and success of that country, far more than any market jitters around citizens being asked to exercise their vote in a plebiscite, constitutional or otherwise. We are trying to end inequality in Scotland. It is morally the right thing to do, but it's also economically the right thing to do. However, the economic benefits of reducing inequality, the fiscal payoff at the other end of the equation, don't all come to Scotland, as has been mentioned by many of my colleagues. When citizens have more money, particularly those in the lower end of the economic spectrum who don't hoard their money or hide it in offshore accounts, they spend that money. As a result, more VAT and corporation tax is collected. VAT, national insurance, corporation tax, all the other ones that Ivan McKee mentioned, is still reserved to the UK government. These are not the only tax levers the UK has that has been used to create inequality and damage to our economy. Let's take a topical example. The Tory two-child policy on tax credits effect on families and work, in work. 50,000 households will be affected and £50 million will be taken out of the pockets of Scottish families by 2020 or 2021. The Institute of Fiscal Studies estimate that a three-child family will lose on average £2,500 per year, while families with four children or more will lose £7,000. No, I don't have time, Mr. Lockhart. Pauline McNeill also rightly points to the long-term effects of such a policy on population growth. And just how many disabled people having their PIP payments taken off them has affected their participation in the economy as their adapted vehicles are taken from them? I'd like to see the figures on that. Despite the drivers of inequality stifling economic prosperity from the UK Tory government, we have good stories to tell around that economic activity of our people. Youth unemployment is at the lowest in the UK, one of the lowest in Europe. Productivity growth in Scotland is four times as fast as the UK, as measured by output per hour worked. Perhaps that's because of our labour market strategies, or our free access to higher education, or our efforts to encourage businesses to pay the living wage. Scotland is the highest pay anywhere in the UK outside London and the southeast of England. Expect that productivity to increase once more once free childcare provision doubles. It will save families an average of £4,500 per year, which means that working women will be increasing Scotland's income tax take. But yet again, all the other benefits of that will be going down to the Treasury in the UK. So here's an idea. Here's an idea to grow Scotland's economy. Give us all the economic powers, Then, and only then, will the Tories not be accused of hypocrisy when they put a miserable, one-sided, finger-pointing motion like this before us.
The last of the open speeches, Tom Arthur, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It's a pleasure to have the opportunity to participate in this debate. It's been a very interesting debate, and I've enjoyed listening to contributions from all sides. Some interesting, some provocative, some just confirming what I already suspected. But I want to sort of pick up on a few things that Murdo Fraser initially said. And now, setting aside some of the other issues, he did identify a couple of things I want to hone in on. He mentioned city deals. And I absolutely agree with him. I think city deals are a fantastic initiative, and certainly as a MSP for Renfrewshire and East Renfrewshire, both Renfrewshire and East Renfrewshire are benefiting substantially from the Glasgow City and Clyde Valley deal. Now, and this is something that the Scottish Government has put £500 million into, and I think that's to be welcomed and it should be recognised. This is actually making a fundamental difference within East Renfrewshire. Over £40 million of investment we have seen from that, the Crossmill Business Centre, a new road network between Barhead, Newton Mearns and the M77, and a new railway station near Auchinbach. All of this has been delivered by having the SNP in administration in East Renfrewshire Council, and my colleague, Councillor Tony Buchanan, who's the convener for infrastructure and growth, has been doing a fantastic job. One of the most exciting developments is going to be the dams to Darnley Country Park. There's going to be a visitor centre, and there's also going to be a wakeboard park. Now, I don't know how many people are aware of what wakeboarding is. To the untrained eye, it's essentially standing on a surfboard and being pulled by a motorboat or a pulley behind up to speeds of 25 to 30 miles an hour. You perform various tricks and that's how you demonstrate your capability. Now, given that this is in East Renfrewshire and there are two MSPs for East Renfrewshire in this chamber, I'm going to challenge Jackson Carlaw today that when that water park opens, he will meet me on the reservoir.
Jackson Carlaw.
I'm very grateful to Mr. Arthur giving way. I mean, it is true that the SNP are two or three of the minority figures in what is otherwise a failing Labour administration in East Renfrewshire. But will he also acknowledge that millions of pounds have been wasted in East Renfrewshire by this administration, particularly over the Cowan Park development, where the council pursued policies which led to over £5 million being added to the cost of the Barhead High School he's talking about, and some estimate potentially as much as £25 million. East Renfrewshire will do very well to be shot at Mr Arthur's party on May the 4th.
Tom Arthur, it's hardly an appropriate intervention for this debate, but if you wish to respond, Mr Arthur, you have no... Mr Arthur? You have no extra time if you wish to respond.
I will simply acknowledge that the key figures in that administration are the SNP figures who have been delivering for Barhead and all of East Renfrewshire and will continue to do so after 4th of May. Now, there was another issue in Murdo Fraser did a serious issue, and that is on the issue of exports and internationalisation. Now, I find it bizarre that he would say this in the chamber because this government has invested in hubs in Dublin, London and Brussels, and including new permanent trade representation in Berlin. Now, I would think that any efforts made by the Scottish Government to increase the internationalisation of our economy would be welcomed. And just a couple of weeks ago, when the First Minister visited the US, you know, announcing fresh investment that will support and create jobs, what was the Tory response? Get on with the day job. Now, clearly, I hadn't realised that what the Tories meant by internationalisation was Empire 2.0. But I'm very sorry to disappoint. This Parliament doesn't have the power to reconstitute the East India Company or compel China to buy opium or whatever other deluded, Brexit-fueled, nostalgic nonsense that you want to go and foist upon us. Now, specifically, one more issue I want to highlight. I'm sorry, I'm pushed for time, otherwise I would... Very briefly.
Jackie Bailey.
As a point of history, it was indeed the Scots that led the opium trade with China.
Yes.
Tom Arthur.
It's a very valid point, and I appreciate that intervention. Now, specifically on the issue, no, I recognise it. Not something I support now, unlike this lot, but never mind. In terms of productivity, which is a very important issue, we've seen productivity grown at four times the rate of the rest of the UK, and that's a highly important issue, and it's something I know other members take an interest in, because with the onset of automation and AI and robotics, this is going to become an increasing challenge for us. You know, productivity is going to be a driver, it's going to be a key issue, it's going to be a key metric, more of a key metric than perhaps it is at the moment. And I think we have to think about that and give it far more cognizance and consideration in our debates about the economic performance of Scotland when we do. I appreciate it's an inconvenient fact for the Conservatives, but I think it's one that rightfully should be highlighted. With the very little time I've got left, I just want to this issue of Scotland being the highest taxed part of the UK. This is categorically untrue. Taken in totality, Scotland is not the highest taxed part of the UK. But what I find very disconcerting is the Conservatives present this argument and they state that higher taxes would undermine consumer confidence and business confidence. Why is it when they believe this to be the case, but they know it not to be the case that Scotland is the highest taxed part of the UK, do they continue to propagate this misinformation of tenuous veracity? I think we should be ashamed of that and take some responsibility.
We now move to the closing speeches, and I notice that there are a couple of members who participated in the debate who aren't in the chamber. Can I first of all call, please, Mike Rumbles. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr. Rumbles.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Well, it's been an interesting but somewhat predictable debate. The Conservatives have concentrated on... Thank you very much. The Conservatives have concentrated on criticising the SNP government for a lack of action on the economy, and absolutely deservedly so. The SNP have concentrated on criticising the UK Conservative government for everything, actually, everything. If only we had a little bit more powers, come the cry from the SNP members, everything would be sweetness and light. The only problem with this is the fact that SNP ministers refuse to use the tax-varying powers to a large extent to make any kind of real difference to the Scottish economy. I'd like to just comment on three or four contributions that members have made, and I'd just like to mention, first of all, Joan McAlpine. I have to say, I wonder where she is. It just seemed one long blame game against the UK government. I mean, I just single her out particularly because she was just quite remarkable with it. She criticised the fact that the UK government failed to use its tax-raising powers, and I thought, how ironic. Wasn't it John Swinney who allowed, when he was finance minister, who allowed our tax-varying powers to lapse, voted for in a referendum of the people? And he allowed it to relapse and kept it quiet from Parliament. It was only discovered at a later date. Great for responsibility, that, Mr. Swinney. Liam Kerr, if I may refer to Liam Kerr, very humorous contribution, very effective contribution. The things that kept him awake at night, and I do sympathise. I do sympathise indeed. But he hit the nail on the head when he pointed out the complacency, I'm afraid, of Scottish Government ministers over a lack of any concrete economic plan to address the problems that face the Scottish economy. And he, George Adam, mentioned the SNP's abolition of tuition fees, which I, for one, was pleased to vote through in the very first session of the Scottish Parliament. It's interesting how people claim various actions when they obviously weren't here themselves to realise that it was the Labour administration with the Liberal Democrat administration that did that. And Gillian Martin focused, as usual, and she didn't say this, but it sort of came across as the nasty things the UK government was doing, instead of focusing on what the Scottish government could be doing, because after all, isn't this the Scottish Parliament where we're focusing on what the Scottish government can do? If Gillian Martin believes that we should be raising taxes to help the less well off, and I say that's an admirable thing to say in a moment, and I'll let me finish and I'll come back to you, then it is within the gift of Scottish ministers to use their income tax powers to do just that. But they don't want to do that. So any criticism by Gillian Martin of the Scottish ministers, I didn't hear a word. I would have more respect for Gillian Martin if she did that. I give way to Gillian Martin.
Gillian Martin.
Yeah, I'm not too bothered about whether you respect me or not, Mr. Rumbles. What I'm bothered about has been misquoted. And I'd like you to point to a part in my speech where I said that we should raise taxes in order to help poorer people, because I did not make that assertion at all.
Mike Rumbles.
I apologise. I was trying to be helpful to her when that's the point I thought she was making. So let's get the record straight. I'm happy to do that. It's just that the speeches she makes so often call for more expenditure, and I thought that's what she meant. If you have more expenditure, then you need to face the consequences of that. I would like to respect the member, and I think it's important that members do respect each other, and I hope to be able to do that. I really hope that the minister, in his summing up, will first of all recognise that the Scottish economy is not in a good place. I think that's the first thing the minister has to do. He hasn't done it yet when he responded to the Conservative opening speech. We could be, and I said this in my opening speech, I hope it isn't the fact, but we could be in recession right now, and there seems to be a huge complacency coming from the front bench of the Scottish Government. To be able to address a problem, you first of all got to accept that a problem exists, and so far we haven't heard that. The Liberal Democrats believe that the Scottish Government has missed a huge opportunity in the budget process, for instance, to invest in the transformational change that we believe we need in our education and skills training base. The Liberal Democrats have a clear vision for the economy of Scotland. I wish the Scottish Government had too. We want to see this transformational investment in education and skills, which is needed by our companies and organisations across the country. We want to keep the country within the single market of the United Kingdom. That is fundamentally important for us. And we want to keep Scotland within the single market of the European Union and avoid a hard Brexit. And I don't have any great expectations of this, but I would still urge members to support our amendment. Thank you.
I call Andy Whiteman. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr. Whiteman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I welcome this debate initiated by Murdo Fraser and the Conservatives. I agree with Murdo that we need to debate Scotland's economy. We need to debate it seriously. But it's hard to take seriously Murdo Fraser and his party, a party who at Westminster are pursuing a reckless, hard Brexit and who are now pursuing a hasty and disruptive general election to settle more internal Conservative Party problems. Now, I think it'll come as no surprise to members that we recognise neither the Conservative gloom in their motion nor indeed arguably some of the sunny optimism of the SNP and other amendments. We're a party who are part of an international movement who have developed green economics over decades, who recognise that endless growth is not possible on a finite planet. Labour's motion, amendment rather, fails to take that into account with its focus on economic growth. Green economics also recognises that the climate crisis is leading to growing instability, unrest and economic decline. We also recognise that to keep within Paris climate targets, we need to keep a majority of hydrocarbons in the ground, hydrocarbons that are often touted by other parties here as part of the economic future of Scotland, and that's why we can't support the SNP amendment either. It's why also in 2015 we commissioned a report that jobs in Scotland's new economy that found that investing in the transferable skills of the offshore workers who currently work in oil and gas could create over 200,000 jobs in the renewable energy industry by 2035, as opposed to the 156,000 jobs currently provided by extracting fossil fuels. Now, none of these ideas are ideas that should keep Liam Kerr awake. No doubt none of these ideas are things that keep Liam Kerr awake at night. And no doubt Liam Kerr also doesn't lose sleep over the fact that whilst he criticises the Scottish Government for lack of a plan, his own party leader, his own government in Westminster is the one with no plan as the UK leaves the EU, and who's sitting with many of his colleagues who stood on a manifesto in 2015 in the general election, a manifesto that promised the voters of the United Kingdom that the Conservatives would preserve the UK's place in the single market. It promised it would strengthen the single market, and it also promised even to expand the single market. We refute much of the Conservative motion's gloom. We would be voting against it. We also refute the gloom of the Liberal Democrats and will be voting against it. As my colleague Patrick Harvey mentioned in his opening, much of the economic progress being trumpeted by the Tories is based on precarious employment, low wages and levels of in and out of work poverty that should shame any industrial society. We heard a contribution from Joan McAlpine highlighting the fact that private debt is a problem in the UK, and indeed it is. The latest figures on private debt show that over £1.5 trillion is owned
is owed by households in the United Kingdom, a figure that's forecast to rise to over £2.3 trillion by 2022. And it's those levels of private borrowing and private debt that are indeed responsible for some of the better economic figures coming out of the UK, but are fundamentally unsustainable. Now, above all, many of the arguments cited by people, members in this debate this afternoon were based on economic data that is not fit for purpose. For example, gross domestic product is a very, very poor indicator of a sustainable economy. It fails to distinguish between useful economic activity and damaging economic activity. And if Murdo Fraser wants to learn a little bit more about the failings of GDP, I recommend he attend a lecture tonight in this building by Professor Lorenz Fioramonte, hosted by Ash Denham. I also recommend that he and others read a very good book, Donut Economics, by Kate Raworth, Senior Visiting Research Associate at Oxford University, Senior Associate at the Cambridge Institute for Sustainable Leadership. It's, although it's called Donut Economics, it's not about people's diet. There's nothing about watermelons or lentils in it. But it does tell us about seven ways in which we can think like 21st century economists. It highlights, for example, a growing recognition that what we measure is of little use if it doesn't meet the real challenges we face. She recalls, for example, classical economic arguments around land, labour and capital, which since the late 20th century have been forgotten in favour of only labour and capital. And yet it's the natural resources, it's the planet, it's the water, the land, the soils, the atmosphere that sustain life on Earth. And if we're to have a serious debate on our economic future, we need to frame the debate around new economic thinking. Now, a number of members, including George Adam and Ash Denham, talked about non-domestic rates, for example, and indeed the small business bonus scheme. And in terms of the practical things we can do in this parliament, yes, we can do practical things with tax. But in our view, for example, the small business bonus scheme is not a terribly helpful scheme. I was speaking to a small business owner the other day in Musselburgh, who was very happy with the fact that she is now paying no rates because of the rising of the threshold. But next door, an empty shop, the rent was being increased in recognition of the fact that the occupier would no longer need to pay rates. And so they are no better off as a consequence. And what's happening is that a tax that might help East Lothian Council in that instance is now being transferred straight into the pockets of a private landlord. We see this also in Edinburgh, where short-term lets are growing. All these owners of property that are part of the consequence of part of the cause of the housing crisis, again, are paying no taxes to Edinburgh City Council. Presiding Officer, Scottish Greens have done a lot since our establishment in 1990 to argue that we need a very different economic model. We can begin that with devolved powers, but we cannot fully realise the transformation without very fundamental change in how the UK economy is run. From its financialisation of the housing markets to its isolationist approach to Europe to rising public and private debt. Presiding Officer, the Green Amendment highlights the real challenges facing the Scottish economy, and I commend it to members.
I call Richard Leonard. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr Leonard.
Thanks, Deputy Presiding Officer. Many people that I speak to on the doorsteps of central Scotland would simply not recognise the economic golden era painted by the government's amendment to the motion this afternoon. In truth, the real rate of unemployment is twice as great as the official figures suggest. And we are living through a period of rising inflation, of a falling, although sometimes oscillating, pound, and Scottish manufacturing output, as a share of GDP, has crashed by 10% over the last 2 years, down to 9% of a share of onshore GDP. And as a result, we have a trade deficit, according to the Scottish Government's own figures, with the rest of the UK of £5.1 billion, with the rest of the world £4.8 billion. We have chronic wage stagnation, which other speakers have referred to, and so long-term real pay cuts for the working poor year on year. And that is a description which applies to workers the Scottish Government itself employs, as well as those in the NHS, in local government, and those in precarious employment in the private sector. And all of this pain for working people, while shareholder dividend payments rose in the last quarter of last year by 11.7%, as the Liberal Democrat amendment suggests, the Scottish economy is teetering on the brink of recession. I take no pleasure in that. That's not something to relish, but it has to be faced up to. We have to face up to it because the contraction of the Scottish economy means painful consequences for jobs. Cuts in not just the standard of living, but in the quality of life, not just for adults in work, but for working age adults who cannot find work, but who want work, and in the quality of life for children being raised in those families. Some of this stems from the immediate crisis we face, from the threat of Brexit and the uncertainty it brings, from the threat of a second independence referendum in 4 years when the people have already said no, and from a Tory government which has reverted to its old armoury of attacking the trade unions and, in so doing, rolling back as much as it can the social responsibility of the idle rich and heaping the financial burden onto the working poor. And to George Adam and others, I say the Conservative government are not anti-Scottish, they are anti-working class. And whilst we haven't yet seen, the Conservative Party manifesto, I guarantee that the start that they have made on undermining trade unions will be considered unfinished business and they will be back for more. And the Brexit mandate they are seeking will be a mandate not to extend but to diminish workers' rights in this country. And we see it here again this afternoon in the Tory amendment, which we will not support, that the only economic programme of the Conservative Party is a tax cut. This is not a serious policy for jobs and growth. It is a recipe for continuing inequality and division. And I hope that that philosophy will be rejected at the polls. But to the SNP, to John McAlpine, Ivan McKee and others, the charge is not that you don't have all of the powers you want, it's that you haven't used all of the powers that you've got. The government amendment says most power over the economy is reserved to the UK government. But what about the power to increase government spending in Scotland and to raise or lower taxation? What about the power to build homes, to create jobs? What about the power to forge an industrial policy and rebuild our manufacturing base? What about the power, the convener of the Education Committee? What about the power over education and training? What about the power to create well-paid, socially useful jobs, looking after the very old and the very young? What about the power? The government amendment speaks of investment in transport, but the government just over 2 weeks ago slashed by almost 30% the low carbon vehicle subsidy element of the bus service operator grant from 14.4 pence per live kilometre to 10.1 pence per live kilometre. The government amendment speaks of a commitment to investment, but at the same time, they are not prepared to set up an investment bank structure worthy of the name. It's been downsized. It should be grown, properly capitalised, so that it could play a transformative role in changing our economy. Because if we are serious about tackling Scotland's productivity gap, Scotland's investment gap, if we are serious about the need for a renaissance in our manufacturing base, the Scottish Investment Bank should be properly capitalised. And let me turn, in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, to say this, because in our view on these benches, our task is clear. It's to lift the scourge of unemployment and reassert full employment as an item of public policy. Let's start the regeneration of our industrial base. Let's give hope to our young people. Let's turn the fear and anger of people of all ages into real hope. And let's use the powers of this Parliament to do that, because that is something that the Labour Party will be advocating in the weeks and months ahead.
I call Keith Brown. Up to 7 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In summing up, I welcome the opportunity to highlight the underlying strengths of the Scottish economy, not least because nobody else in this chamber will, in terms of other parties, and also its resilience over the past couple of years and the actions that we are taking to support growth in our economy and protect Scotland from the impacts of a hard Brexit. As Paul Weale has set out at the start of the debate, the Scottish economy is fundamentally strong, but he also mentioned, despite what Mike Rumbles has said, that we do have challenges. And I've mentioned before, we have challenges in terms of internationalisation, making more of our companies involved in international activity, thereby increasing exports. We have challenges also in relation to productivity. It's true, as many people have said, that productivity in Scotland has grown by 9.4% since 2007, compared to growth of 0.1% in the UK as a whole. But that shouldn't be the bar that we aim for. Other countries like Germany and France have higher productivity. That's what we should be aiming for. It's also true to say, of course, Scottish employment is now 45,000 higher than it was in 2008. And just, I'll come back to the point raised by Dean Lockhart in a few minutes about the growth over a period of time. But we should remember, since 2008, we've had one of the longest and deepest recessions in the UK's history. Now, despite these challenges, Scotland has substantial natural resources, one of the most highly educated workforces in Europe, a long-standing reputation for innovation, and an internationally recognised brand. We are world leaders now in key industries of the future, such as life sciences, financial services, and financial technology, as well as creative industries and sustainable tourism. And in that context, it's worth bearing in mind the productivity. I will take a brief intervention from Mike Rumbles.
Mike Rumbles.
Just indicate whether he believes that the Scottish economy is in recession at the moment or is in the danger of being in recession. And if he believes we're not in recession, well, OK, go on.
Keith Brown.
The figures don't demonstrate that Scotland's in recession, and I'm not going to play a game of trying to talk Scotland into recession, as some people want to do. So that's what the figures currently say just now. As well as the fact that we have, as I've mentioned, the figures in terms of productivity and also in relation to employment, it's worth saying that really this debate, and I think it might have been Gillian Martin, in fact, no, it was Andy Whiteman, said that really, looking at Murdo Fraser's contribution, this is not a serious debate for the Conservatives. They're not treating this debate seriously. Look at the terms of the motion. Well, if he was treating it seriously, then I think you'd see, first of all, that take, for example, his stunning, acute economic insight into a bit like his unique understanding of the Laffer curve, actually. The unique insight that he's got when Gillian Martin made mention of the economic impact of transfer payments, financial transfer payments, things like the rape clause will have an influence on that. To not understand the economic impact of transfer payments shows the economic illiteracy of the Conservative Party. It's also true to say that... if I can make a bit more progress just now and see how time goes. Murdo Fraser also showered Jackie Bailey with praise, his favourite Labour MSP. I think he was only cut off just before he was able to deliver that invitation to come to a Conservative branch meeting, which I know Jackie Bailey is quite keen to do as well. We had mention from Murdo Fraser in relation to tax as well, but no mention as to why the Conservative Party has flip-flopped back and forward in terms of APD. They didn't support it, they did support it, they weren't sure it should be done across the whole of the UK. So the Conservative Party, as well as having U-turns on things, small things like snap general elections, also has U-turns on things like the APD. It's also true to say that if you look at what's behind the Conservative comments, many of the contributors that were there. It's harking back to a 1980s kind of economic model. It's kind of Thatcherism, the kind of rancid, toxic Tory kind of legacy that we had. And the recession that we had in the 1990s, the recession that we had in 2008, the foundations for that were laid in the 1980s in terms of, again, as Andy Whiteman said, in terms of personal borrowing and so on. The build-up and the lack of banking regulation were fundamental to that. You may remember it being characterised as kind of the Alan Bastard level of economic competence. And I don't know how many people on the Tory side see themselves as Alan Bastards, but I can tell you it's not an economic model that we intend to follow. So it's not a serious debate that we've presented with by the Conservative Party. There are very serious issues. There have been some very serious contributions that, by and large, have not come from the Conservative Party. If I can mention Rachel Hamilton, who I think adopted a new line for the Conservative Party, which was to be against the TripAdvisor innovation that the FM has signed up to in the States. Now, that has actually been accepted by, I think it was Douglas Ross, who welcomed it at the time. Ross Thompson, who welcomed, and I'm sorry, I always confuse the two, I'm apologising. I see your face already. I thought I was going to get sent off there for a second, but so it's been condemned by one but accepted by another. It's not exactly economic literacy, but Rachel Hamilton, I think, wants to say I've misunderstood her. I'm happy to give way to her on this point.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you to Keith Brown. I would like to point out that I said that it is unregulated, and if you looked at the United Hoteliers Facebook page, you would realise that they do not support it. And I believe that a combination of Visit Scotland and TripAdvisor is not a good combination if it's unregulated.
Keith Brown.
You simply said you didn't agree with it, and I'm just saying that other parts of your party do agree with it, and maybe you should try and get your act together in relation to that.
Here.
Despite those things, I do think there's an underlying strength. Scotland's economy has proved its resilience over a number of years. We have had growth in 2016 by 0.4%. I've mentioned how unemployment has fallen £47,000 over the past year, and that the unemployment rate is now below that of the UK. Now, I mentioned that it's not the only indicator. I'm not trying to pretend that it is, but it's been the subject of previous Tory press releases when that was the defining characteristic of the competence or otherwise of the Scottish Government. If it is, and we are lower than the UK, you should draw the conclusion from that. You can't have it both ways. The Scottish Government will continue to implement its widely admired economic strategy based around the twin pillars of boosting competitiveness and tackling inequality. And the point was made about inequality very powerfully by a number of speakers. That is why we've had the emphasis that we've had on inclusive economic growth. That's why we've had the emphasis and the success that we've had in terms of the living wage. Second highest sign-up rate across the whole of the UK. However, it's true to say, of course, that latest GDP data shows there is no room for complacency. There is no complacency in relation to this. We have laid out time and time again the measures which we intend to take. And for those that call for ideas, make your ideas. We've had one or two, one from Gillian Martin. We've had one from Andy Whiteman. I think the points that Andy Whiteman made in relation to data collection, I have a lot of sympathy. That's why the Economic and Skills Enterprise Review is looking at that. But we also have to recognise what the real challenges are, the challenges in the oil and gas sector, and to try and pretend that Brexit's not having an impact. At some point, you've got to say to yourself, everybody else is saying it, everyone else knows it's going on. For the Scottish Tories to be the sole group of people in the UK that don't see the impact of Brexit just makes you, it means you've got less credibility than otherwise you would have, and that's not great in the first place. So there's a great deal which we are succeeding with in the Scottish economy. I would just say finally that in relation to the motion before us, I would ask the Parliament to support the amendment in my name and also to oppose the amendment, the motion from the Conservative Party. I'm always happy to have a serious debate in the Scottish economy, but this is not that debate, and that's down to the Tory motion that's before us today. Support my amendment in my name.
I call on Dean Lockhart to close this debate. Up to 9 minutes, please, Mr. Lockhart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. We called this debate today because Scotland's economy is facing a crisis. As we've heard, the economy contracted by 0.2% in the final quarter of last year, zero growth in the 12 months up to that period, and all sectors of the active economy are in decline. All of this at the same time as the wider UK economy is the fastest growing economy in Europe. Despite this, the SNP amendment today refers to the strength of the economy in Scotland. Is this really what stronger for Scotland under the SNP means? Economic decline, underperformance and stagnation. This economic crisis is more than just falling GDP. This decline is having a direct impact on people across Scotland. As Murdo Fraser highlighted, workers in Scotland have had the lowest pay rise of any part of the UK. Rachel Hamilton told us about struggling high streets and that Scotland is losing shops faster than any other part of the UK. Jamie Green pointed out that business and consumer confidence is down. And Jackie Bailey highlighted that retail sales are falling. In a desperate effort to try to salvage some good news, Keith Brown tells us that the unemployment is down in Scotland and productivity is up. But this would be welcome if it were true, because the underlying reasons, in closer scrutiny, we see that the fall in unemployment has been caused by higher levels of economic inactivity in Scotland. And the main reason there's an increase in productivity is because last year, less hours were worked. That's not positive news.
Exactly.
Let me be clear, we're not talking down Scotland. Leading organisations share our deep concern about the economy. The Scottish Chamber of Commerce warn of a red alert on the economy and are calling for urgent change of government policy. And the Fraser of Allander Institute voices serious concerns over the economy. Presiding Officer, one of the key questions this Parliament needs to address is how did we get to this position? Scotland has world-class universities, world-class cities and a world-class workforce, but we find ourselves suffering from long-term economic underperformance and we're facing a recession. The simple answer is that after 10 years in power, the SNP must take full responsibility for the, I will later, the SNP must take full responsibility for this mess and stop blaming others. Contrary to what we've heard from Keith Brown, and I will allow him to intervene in a second, contrary to what we've heard, Brexit is not to blame for this economic decline. Yeah. Fraser of Allander makes this clear. when they say it's hard to argue that Scotland's weaker performance can be explained by the outcome of the EU referendum. End of quotation and end of story. Brexit is not to blame. I'll give way.
Keith Brown.
I wonder if I could just try something I've tried in previous debates to see whether it's possible for Dean Lockhart to acknowledge the fact that there are two governments involved in the Scottish economy. UK government ministers can acknowledge that fact. Julie Martin made this point as well. Can this group of Conservatives now acknowledge the fact that the UK government is an active participant in the Scottish economy and shares responsibility for what happens in it?
Dean Lockhart.
Well, what I'd say to Mr Brown is that the Scottish government's own chief economist confirmed to the Economy Committee last year, and I quote, "All levers that impact on the underlying competitiveness of the economy now lie with the Scottish Government." So, Brexit's not to blame, and neither is the oil price to blame. The latest economic data shows that all areas of the manufacturing sector in Scotland declined last year, not just those tied to the North Sea supply chain. Now, let's make it clear. Economic decline we're experiencing right now is not caused by Brexit, the oil price, or Westminster. The responsibility lies solely with the SNP. In the past year alone, we have seen the actions of a government that simply does not understand how the economy works. We've had a budget that makes Scotland the highest tax part of the UK, and that cut, we've had, a budget that cut enterprise funding by 40%. I'll take an intervention. Do you want to explain why cutting the enterprise budget by 40% is going to be good for the economy? Can you explain that?
Tom Arthur.
Scotland is not the highest tax part of the UK. Fraser of Allander and others have demonstrated that categorically. Now, will the member withdraw his remarks?
Dean Lockhart.
All you need to look at is the large business supplement. I could go on, but I don't have time. In addition to a budget that is bad for the economy, we have seen punitive increases in business rates across Scotland. Murdo Fraser has highlighted the crippling impact of the rate revaluations. Last week, I had a constituent who told me that his rates are going from £30,000 a year to £95,000 a year. The business owner has been advised to consider taking the roof off his business premises in order to avoid bankruptcy. Just one further example of the damage inflicted by this SNP government. Further, on the Enterprise and Skills Review, we've seen a screeching U-turn by the Cabinet Secretary after his plans for a super quango were stopped by this Parliament. We've had the £500 million growth scheme, but with no new funding and no sign of activity 8 months after it was launched. And we've had the Chinese investment shambles, with the SNP being called a shambles by international investors. I could go on, but time is limited. Scotland's economy has suffered not only a decade of incompetence, but also a decade of neglect, as the SNP has prioritised its campaign for separation over economic growth. As the First Minister told us last year, the question of independence transcends the issues of Brexit, oil and national wealth. A statement that shows for the SNP, nationalism is more important than national wealth, independence is more important than income, and separation is more important than Scotland's success. And these are not just empty words. When the SNP set up a growth commission last year, it wasn't a growth commission that Scotland's economy so badly needs. It was a growth commission for independence, making the task of selling independence more attractive, if that's possible. So, instead of the First Minister and other ministers gallivanting around the US and Europe, can I suggest that you focus 100% on turning around the economy? Imagine if all that energy was devoted to building new business in Scotland, driving innovation and expanding our export base. We would not be in this mess. So the SNP have a clear choice to make: economic growth or their continued obsession with independence. Our priority is economic growth. Together with leading organisations across Scotland, we are calling for an urgent change in government policy. We're calling for the SNP to actively participate in the industrial strategy published by the UK government to maximise opportunities across all sectors and industries in Scotland. We're calling for our cities and local areas to become Scotland's engines of growth through the city deals, growth deals and local growth partnerships. To do this, we have published today our local government manifesto, which sets out a framework of measures that will drive local economies. We're calling on the SNP to create a competitive tax system in Scotland, and we're calling for an enterprise and skills review that will expand our export base. Having 50 companies account for over 50% of our exports is not sustainable. And yes, we're calling on the SNP to stop their endless campaign for separation and prioritise the economy. Presiding officer, the SNP have had 10 years to fix the economy. Instead, their track record is one of economic decline, a broken domestic agenda, and a nation more divided than ever. In the weeks to come, voters will cast their verdict on a lost decade of SNP government. Voters will have the chance to send a clear message to the SNP, a message that after 10 years in government, the SNP have not been stronger for Scotland, they have been a disaster for Scotland. Presiding officer, I support the motion in Murdo Fraser's name.
Thank you. That concludes our debate. That concludes our debate on Scotland's economy. The next item of business is consideration of three business motions in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau. Motion 5210, setting out a business programme. Motions 5189 and 5190, setting out stage one timetables for two bills. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against any of the motions to press their request to speak button now. I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move the motions on block.
Moved on block.
Thank you. And no member is asked to speak against the motions. I therefore propose to put a single question on these motions. If any member objects, please say so now. The question is that motions 5188, 5189 and 5190 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The next item of business is consideration of two Parliamentary Bureau motions. I ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motions 5191 and 5192 on the establishment of private bill committees.
Moved.
Thank you, and we'll put that at decision time. There are seven questions to be put as a result of today's business. I remind members that if the amendment in the name of Keith Brown is agreed, then all of the other amendments fall. The first question is that amendment 5172.3 in the name of Keith Brown, which seeks to amend the motion 5172 in the name of Murdo Fraser on Scotland's economy, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote, and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 5172.3 in the name of Keith Brown is yes 62, no 55. The amendment is therefore agreed. All the other amendments are therefore preempted. So the next question is that motion 5172 in the name of Murdo Fraser as amended on Scotland's economy be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to division. Members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion 5172 in the name of Murdo Fraser as amended is yes 62, no 55. The motion is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 5191 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on the establishment of a private bill committee be agreed. Are we all agreed? And the final question is that motion 5192 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on the establishment of a private bill committee is agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. That concludes decision time. We'll move to members' business in the name of Monica Lennon. I will just take a few moments for members to change seats.